You are now entering the world of Musings of a Geek Podcast Network. Stay geeky, my friends.
This is a Danger Entertainment Podcast. DangerEntertainment.net. Danger Entertainment Podcast Network.
Hey there, kids. Do you want to hear a show where a bunch of guys sit around in a comic book store and talk about comics and lifestyle choices, other goofy things and shenanigans they get up to?
Have we ever talked about comics? Usually it's people sitting on my lap and riding the struggle bus.
That's true. It's mostly shenanigans. but occasionally we talk about comics. And if you like any of those things, comics, shenanigans, Devin's lap, then you need to check out Snake Oil Comics with me, Travis, and my beautiful co-host, Big Dev.
Find us on iTunes, Stitcher, and snakeoilcomics.com.
All right. About comic books, movies, growing up with Broke Suki. Superman before Zack Snyder ruined him.
Man,
Michael Keaton was the best Batman, while Christian Bale was just deadpan. No one remembers the other ones. Princess Leia in bikinis,
oh, yeah.
And Transformer Lamborghinis.
Hell yeah.
Please don't let Shia LaBeouf ever act again.
Please, God, no.
Remembering tales from the crypt, back when Michael Bay wrote good scripts.
He wrote good
all
scripts.
Right here. It's no mystery, cause it's the history of bad.
It's bad.
It's the history of bad.
So bad.
It's the history of bad ideas. It's the history of bad.
It's bad.
It's the history of bad.
So bad.
It's the history of bad ideas.
Podcast.
Welcome to the History of Bad Ideas, episode number 91. I'm Jason.
I'm Jeff.
I'm Blake.
And with us in the studio is, back after a five-week hiatus, number one fan, Doug.
Woo!
Welcome.
Yay.
I heard Jim on here last week, and it's like, he wants my number one spot. I'm not going to let him have it. In fact, I brought swag just to suck up to you guys.
Is that why we have a fresh supply of Pez?
Now, time out, though.
That is partly why we have a fresh supply of Pez.
That's awesome.
I think he bought this like 6 months ago. I finally got through the end of it.
You've been holding it from me?
Yeah, it's been, yeah.
Bastard.
Well, Doug did bring gifts this week, because as much as I love Tomorrowland, he got me the George Clooney character, Walker.
What's Tomorrowland?
That movie I talked about when they go into the future. It's Disney-related.
Oh, yeah, that one.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
You remember he started talking and you tuned out?
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, what do we got going on this week?
So anyway, so he got me Tomorrowland, and you think I should open it or you think the value goes down?
You just ruined it.
You just opened it.
It's a Pop Funko. Is this Funko?
Yeah.
Okay. The big head guys.
By Whammy.
The big heady guys, yeah.
For the record, I paid $1.19 for it.
And why did you spend? How did it become
$1.19? Too much.
Taxes.
I should have bought a whole army of them, but
it was a dollar, but they had it 19 cents.
So I've never bought these Pop guys. I always think they're cool looking, but I just don't know why I would ever buy one. Now, this one's different because of it. I've never felt these before. That's, like, spongy. Have you ever felt those? Like, hard plastic, but it's, like, little... I was expecting a bobblehead.
It's kind of like the early version of fake breasts.
I hope not.
I hope they don't look like George Clooney, the fake breast.
No, I thought you were talking about the description of how they felt.
Oh, you can turn
his head. I hope they don't... Yeah, the early fake breasts didn't feel like that.
Because it kind of brought back memories.
Well, I'm going...
Of bad stripper poop jobs.
How many bad stripper boob jobs do you know of?
I've blocked them all out.
Okay.
Early pre-marriage.
Okay.
Pre-marriage.
Before marriage.
Okay. So you meant early part of the marriage. Well, good for you.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Okay. A lot of Destinies and Ashleys on there. Destiny coming to the stage.
Porsche and Mercedes.
Cinnabon? The Brian Adams movie?
Oh, yeah.
With the horse?
Cinnabon.
There was a horse involved, but that's something different.
Okay.
So, Doug, thank you. I'm going to...
My pleasure.
I'm going to put this in the credenza of fame, I think.
I should go there.
So, to talk amongst yourself for a second.
I'd like to bring up something, because Jeff mentioned it last week, and just so he knows, you can't have facial hair at Disney.
You can't.
Your dream of being a cast member is not dead.
So they changed it. I thought they might have changed it a couple years back.
They changed. Mustaches was like 2000 and beards. Just
wait a minute. Dopey doesn't have a beard.
Well, if you're playing Dopey, then you can't have a beard.
My thing was,
Doc does though, doesn't he?
How can you get on Disney when your favorite team just allowed facial hair almost at the same time? It's insane.
Well, at the same time, that was 99.
Right.
Okay.
When Marge Schott died.
When did she die?
No, I don't think.
Marge still had it at that time, I think.
Yeah.
Did she?
Because of Greg Vaughn.
Greg Vaughn.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Greg Vaughn begged them to let him keep his facial hair when they traded for him, and that's when they suspended the...
Team's gone downhill ever since.
They have. 99 is their last shot at the playoffs.
Wait a minute. I'm very upset the Reds cannot lose 99 games this year.
I'm thrilled they can't lose 100 games. Yeah.
I was hoping for it, so... Anyways, Blake, you have a story, don't you? I heard you went to Cleveland this weekend. Story time?
Story time. Story time. Story time with Blake. This story may not make any sense, but you tell it to us anyway. So sit back and relax. Story time with Blake.
Oh. How are the Browns? How were they?
In my adult life.
So the last 3 years.
In my adult life, going back before that technically, due to age, not legal. Every time I've gone to a Cleveland Browns home game up in Cleveland where I make the, you know, the Hajj, you know, it's like my Muslim Hajj trip, except we don't trample other Browns fans to death.
Usually.
Is there any other Browns fans?
Yeah, there are.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Oh, there they exist. They're there.
Yes, exactly. With Chris.
Mm-hmm. Bednar.
Musician to the HOBI. Musician to the HOBI and the story time with Blake.
Mm-hmm.
Theme song,
mm-hmm. You know, writer, singer, songwriter, and Dave Cool.
Mm-hmm.
Another good friend of the podcast.
Yeah.
You know, his wife's a big poster and fan. And we usually make a trip up to the Mecca of Hell, which is called Cleveland Brown Stadium, which is now called First Energy Stadium.
They changed the name. I missed that.
Yes, they did. You know, every devil has their dollar. Every time I've gone to Cleveland, we have lost in epic fashion. Up to the point where Mr. Bednar had boycotted any more games up until this point where we looked at the schedule and said, hey, we should be able to beat the Raiders in week 3 because in week 3 we should still have some kind of hope and it won't be too hot and it won't be too cold. So going back to my adult history of going to Browns games in the Cleveland Browns 2.0 era, I was at the Kansas City Chiefs Dwayne Rudd helmet throw after they the first victim of the new you can't take your helmet off on the field 15-yard penalty. I was there with Mr. Bednar and Cool and our friend Verm. And
is that in your top 5 tonight for favorite sports moments?
No, we can get to that later. I was there for the helmet toss with Dwayne Rudd. I was in the dog pound yelling and screaming what we thought was a sack of Trent Green. And I just know I was upended. Somehow my feet were above my head. I was 3 rows down somewhere else. And by the time I got up, I saw the field goal. No, I saw a lineman with the ball running down the field. And then the field goal team marched 15 extra yards down the field because of the flag and kicked a field goal. And everybody in the dog pound was like, what the hell just happened? We lost that one. Tim Couch, sub-zero to freezing degrees. The beer in my mug was actually freezing in the top 2 to 3 inches because it was so damn cold there on the lake. That was when XFL flunky He Hate Me for the Carolina Panthers.
Oh, Rod Smart.
Set a single-game rushing record against the Cleveland Browns, and we lost that game. Then there was the other game with the Atlanta Falcons where we had our second string quarterback. It was one of those mobile Detroit Lions quarterbacks that
your team had the second
string. Yeah, we had the second string. We thought we had a chance because Abraham, the defensive end for the Falcons, was out, and
John.
His backup was in. Yeah, John Abraham, and we had the second string Detroit Lions. I forget mobile quarterback who got eliminated. We were down to like somebody like Thad Lewis, and we were still winning going into the fourth quarter. And the backup for John Abraham, who had played no important part at all in the game, hits the quarterback and fumbles, and the ball bounces up into his hands, and he runs it 45 yards back for a touchdown and wins the game. There was the Baltimore Ravens versus the Browns where Derek Anderson dropped back to pass and, like, literally almost did, like, a handoff to the defensive tackle for the Ravens who was coming in to sack him. It was like, oh, here's the ball. I'm going to throw it. No, here you go. And then, like, the Ravens guy was like, what the fuck am I doing with this ball? I have no idea what this is doing. And he runs it 50 yards towards me at the opposite end of the dog pound, and the Ravens win the game.
So what about this Sunday?
This Sunday, of course, we're down 20-3, and we're like, why in the fuck are we here? let's see. Derek Carr, who we passed up in the draft, threw for over 300 yards. Let me see. Amari Cooper, who we passed up on, like, caught for over 100 yards. Oh, the sixth-round draft pick, running back, Latavius, who the fuck his name Murphy is, Murray, ran for over 100 yards, and for the first time in 25 first time ever, three players under 25 had like over 100-yard, 300-yard things together. It's the first Ravens road victory since like what 2003 or something.
Raiders went over first 3,000 days.
3,000 days since they won on the road
in the East Coast.
The East Coast and everything else. And I just watched the.
So you saw history.
I saw history of the way that the Cleveland Browns lose every
You know, I stayed home on my couch and I was able to watch them the same effect. I think I probably would have done the same if I were you.
You were able to watch them on your couch?
Well, I saw the highlights. That was enough. Yeah, but the best. I saw the score and I saw Facebook of Blake and all the guys up there. I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. They all went up there. I looked up the score, 23. That's not cool. Sorry.
And then
about
we
that.
Started coming back and the defense actually does something. And then the star from the week before, Travis Benjamin.
Yeah.
Three touchdowns. Now he gets a punt. He calls a fair catch. And he fumbles a fair catch. And the Raiders get the ball back. And we get it back on our 3 minutes later. And then we're moving down the field. And I'm sitting there going, well, after Travis Benjamin fumbled, I just held my head in my two hands. And I just started laughing hysterically, yelling, this only happens to us. This only happens to us. And this only happens when I come to games. Which people around me are like, we know.
We've been doing this for 18 years
like,
now.
But no, but this only happens this way when I am there.
McCown threw a nice pass at the end.
And then they're marching down the field. And I'm like, is it possible that this shitty quarterback who made horrible passes all day, he's going to lead us to victory 98 yards down? Oh, before the drive started, I had to run to the bathroom and take a leak. And there was some guy in there going, well, you know, 98 yards, John Elway did it. And I just started laughing hysterically. I started laughing hysterically, and I said, you know, I'm laughing hysterically. You just brought up John Elway, and I'm taking a piss.
Would you take John Elway now as a quarterback?
Screw that horse-faced asshole. So I run back out, and I'm able to see the drive start, and we're moving down the field, moving down the field, moving down the field, moving down the field. And son of a bitch, I'm sitting here thinking, is it possible in all my years of coming to games here that this is going to change? This could be the year that we could actually win in a dramatic fashion, and therefore it would justify my existence as a Browns fan. And I thought about that for a second. I watched him go back to pass, Travis Benjamin wide open. I saw the pass. I'm like, it's short. And all of a sudden I saw 50-year-old Charles Woodson, you know, who can model himself after the Heisman Trophy now because he's that fucking old, comes in and picks off the underthrown pass. And I just start laughing. I'm like, no, there's no other way. There's no other way that this can end. This is it. This is the only way it can end. And it did.
I think he's the oldest guy to do an interception, too, so that makes you feel good. It's a history. You saw a lot of history this weekend.
As I always do. Yeah. The next game that I'm going to, I'll let everybody know ahead of time so they can all tune in and watch this. What the fuck the Browns are going to do historic-wise?
Tune in. I'm dropping bets on that
There's
game.
There's fucking NFL Network. You can watch whatever you want now. NFL Sunday.
Bengals won this week. Cardinals won this week.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah.
Patriots won this week. Doug's team.
I'll let you know it.
Yeah.
Boo.
Tom Brady versus the world because he's pissed off.
No doubt.
Sorry, Jacksonville.
Yeah. So we can keep the Giants out of the Super Bowl.
You're good. It's all right. I'm going to the Bengals game this week, so hopefully they don't do what you did. What you did.
Well, wait a minute. I did go to a Browns game where we won. That was the first regular season game in Paul Brown Stadium. That's where touchdown Travis Prentice from Miami University scored a touchdown. And we beat the Bengals in Paul Brown Stadium. I did see a game where the Browns won. I forgot all about it.
I mean, you're not allowed to go to Cleveland Brown Stadium to watch the Browns.
Yeah, that's correct. And after the victory, we did pee on Paul Brown Stadium to mark our territory like good dogs.
Well, if you did that to Mike Brown, you could have.
Yeah.
In person, that would have been fine. Well, last year when I went to the Bengals game, they were 0-1-1. They lost to the Browns in the most embarrassing Thursday night game ever. And then they tied Carolina. So that was a fun season. Thanks for those two games that I went to.
Yeah, there was a game that we won. That was, of course, it wasn't in Cleveland, though. That's fine.
Yeah. I'm sorry. How many playoff wins? Oh, wait. We don't have any playoff wins either. Never mind. How many playoff appearances? anyways, let's start.
Hey, we have NFL championships.
Nah, that doesn't count. Those don't count.
That was pre-Super Bowl.
Why don't they count?
Because it's pre-Super Bowl. It's like the XFL championship. It doesn't count. Anyways.
Pre-Super Bowl still counts. You still have championships.
Doesn't count. Nope.
The league was there.
I am making a point. No.
Your point's invalid.
Well, fine.
So the 27 Yankees don't count because they're
no, no. 1919 Reds do.
Well, they hit the World Series then.
Oh, okay.
So that's the difference.
The World Series. Okay, yeah. I see.
As long as it's the championship that we currently have, so if they just stop, say, the Stanley Cup playoffs, then anything that happened before doesn't count, and the new one is the only one that matters. So the Brigger Cup playoffs are the only ones that matter from here on out.
So anyways, we're on nerdly.co.uk. Check them out for all the latest reviews of DVDs, movies, comics, comic cons,
yeah, of course,
TV shows.
UK people, we're talking American football, not, you know, Liverpool shit.
We're done now. We're done.
That's right.
Okay, Blake, start us off with listener feedback.
Listener feedback from Doug.
Number one fan.
Go ahead, read it, baby.
What were your thoughts on Heroes Reborn?
I liked it.
Okay.
It felt like the first season of Heroes again, where you're getting all these different stories, you don't know how they're going to interact, and they're just developing as it goes. Granted, this is only after one episode.
Two.
Did it have its first
I've only
episode
seen,
last
oh,
week?
Oh, it's a two-hour episode.
Did that play this last past week?
Yeah, Thursday. Played on Thursday.
Yeah. Now, but now, the whole time we were leading up to it, it was touted as none of the old heroes are going to be there, but all of a sudden, oh, wait a minute, they all are, except for Hayden Panettiere.
Pretty much.
Right?
No, they...
The Haitian was there.
Unless it did a crossover with her Nashville. That would be fucking...
That would be awesome.
No, I think, you know, Greg Grunberg was always on board to be coming back.
Well, yes, Greg Grunberg is on board for anything.
Anytime someone will pay him to act, he'll be there.
Did they answer the question of how not saving the cheerleader saved the world?
No.
They just rebooted it, said, screw it, we're starting over again. Here you go. 30 years later, boom.
Spoiler alert, the Haitian is in it for like 30 seconds.
Way to spoil it.
Yeah. I didn't say what happened. Anyways, I did have an issue with the Japanese swordswoman.
Anti-hero?
Yeah, that was a little...
The
being sucked into the video game thing wasn't...
That was embarrassing. Yeah. It was boring. It was stupid. That was the most pointless 20 minutes of the show that I saw.
It might turn into something.
No, it won't.
It might.
It's stupid.
Got sucked into a video game? What are you talking about?
Yeah, her superpower, she goes into a video game.
Pitfall?
if it was Pitfall, it would have been even better.
Pac-Man.
Beat him and eat him.
Well, beat him and eat him, yes.
Burger Town. your favorite video game?
She couldn't get the lettuce down, though.
No.
So that was awful. Take a drink. I thought the rest of it was okay. Decent. I like horn rim glasses. I like him.
I like
H-E-R.
Yeah, I'm intrigued with Zachary Levi and his wife or whatever.
He's going to turn it good, isn't he?
Maybe, maybe not.
I think he's going to end up killing her at the very end.
That could be.
So I thought that was interesting, an interesting take. Unfortunately, some of the guys that in the very beginning in the meeting with the powers, I liked those guys better than some of the heroes that we followed throughout the whole rest of it. I was like, I liked the coach with the fire, and I liked the old man that's speedy.
Speedy old man?
Yeah, he just kept going into a corner, though. He didn't know where he was going.
I thought this was an open door!
His walker with the tennis balls got in the way. Couldn't get away. It was okay. I'll keep watching. I'll see how it is. We got some more on Fall TV a little bit later on I want to talk about. Actually, in listener feedback. Go ahead, Blake. Keep going.
Doug was at Doug. You only had one line.
He was weak this week.
Usually you have your own little mini segment. Are you sure you don't want to add one?
No, because it'll get political, and you know I know they don't want to go there.
All right. I mean,
Vader in 2016, Darth Vader.
That's right, Vader 16. All right, from Jillian at Sheer Jillians.
Yes.
What a genius name
it
for
is.
A handle. Regarding top five lairs, wherever Charlie is, when he contacts his angels, I'm convinced he's a crime-fighting peeping Tom.
I can understand that.
I completely agree. Where did they ever solve where Charlie was?
No, they never met Charlie.
Shazam's van.
He just always knew that the angels were there watching them dress, undress, live, eat.
It's kind of creepy.
Shower.
I do remember one time on Charlie's Angels, like, the angels were brought onto like one of these islands where the bad guys are hunting them down or whatnot. They're doing one of those greatest game things or whatever.
Hunger Games thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Were they wearing bikinis?
Probably.
They probably had to. Yeah. I mean, it was the 70s. Yeah.
But they escaped and fought and beat the bad guy. But they heard, you know, Charlie was so concerned he was coming to the island to meet him, and they see his boat coming, and they were thinking, should we let him know we're safe, or should we let him come to the island so we can finally meet him? So they eventually radioed him, and his boat turned around and left.
Oh,
and it's interesting. Like, really? That's still kind of a dick move.
It's a very dick move.
You should still go pick him up.
Who, a fire?
Speaking of Charlie's Angels, Farrah Fawcett, the iconic poster that every teenage boy in the 1970s
red bathing
had.
Suit, yeah.
I wasn't born yet.
Yeah. Go ahead. Those ice cutters. Mm-hmm. Have you ever seen the poster?
Yes, I've seen the poster.
Those nipples could, like, cut glass.
Yes, yes.
I mean, they were hard as diamonds.
Yes, yes. Are you going somewhere with this?
I just wanted to bring it up.
Okay, thank you. Okay, good, good.
Now you're talking about it. It's off now.
Exactly. I mean, I think Charlie's Angels, I think Farrah Fawcett, I think the iconic poster, and I think about her.
Did you see
those glass-cutting nipples?
Did you see they're trying to remake it now?
Again?
Yeah, keep going. I'll tell you what they're trying to do with it.
All right. Well, anyways, Jillian goes on to say, mine, she's not talking about her nipples, okay?
her layers, cartoon, her favorite layers.
Carbon inspired. No, wait, I mean, not nipples. Her, mine are entirely cartoon inspired. Like the,
Real Monster
Scare School.
Yes.
She's talking about her layers.
The top five layers.
Yeah, top five layers.
Of course, according
I've never watched Real Monsters, so I don't know these scares.
Of course, according to Musings Network last week, we were actually doing top five liars. So,
yes, yeah. So if you tuned in to hear our top five liars, you were disappointed.
Yes, yes. It's very political based if we do liars. thank you, Jillian. Sorry, it's Blake. Thank you, Jillian. She gave us the top five layers last week.
Yes, that was her
top
suggestion.
Five liars. Awesome.
Yes.
I mean, layers.
Moving on.
365 Flicks Podcast at 365 Flicks Pod says, not my wife, but Flicks Podcast wants to know. My wife, I'm their wife, wants to know, bedroom role play, Harley or Leia?
Harley Quinn or Princess Leia?
Why not both?
Well, you have...
You have to choose one or the other, Jeff.
Why?
Because that's the question.
Oh.
Because our listeners give us these...
I'm going Leia.
Intuitive, thoughtful, thought-provoking choices.
I'm still going both.
Okay. Okay. Anyone else?
Is this Leia. Who we dress up as?
No. You're with a significant other. I think Leia is the white one, though,
or
from Star Wars. The
both
the
significant
white outfit.
Others while I sit back and watch.
Oh, not Slave Leia?
Well, I'm kidding. Yes, it would be Slave Leia.
Of course.
No, Hoth Leia.
Hoth Leia. Oh, look at all those layers.
Hey, you just alienated all of our Canadian listeners.
Hey, what's up, Boot? Elizabeth Banks is doing the new one, Charlie's Angels.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Are they going to make it all men, since they're taking all the men roles and making
them
women?
She's going to be Charlie?
Oh, she's going to be Charlie. That would be great. And then they'll just have a bunch of, like, super sexy studs running around solving crime.
She said she would like to do it as an R-rated film.
I would like it to be an R-rated film.
Okay, get your head out of the gutter, people.
I meant for violence. R-rated for violence.
I thought it was R for Randy.
All right, Jason's laughing at something tweeted.
I'll tell you what.
Doug hasn't answered the question yet.
Leia. I go with Leia.
You go with Leia?
Yeah.
I think Leia has a bigger body of work that we can reference in the bedroom. So I would have to go Leia.
In the bedroom.
Michelle, if you're listening, Leia in the bedroom. Leia.
Sounds like you're playing Clue. Leia in the bedroom. With
Leia
the
in the bedroom
pipe.
With a chain.
Lead pipe.
Leia in the bedroom with the vibrator. I mean, handcuffs. I mean,
I can't
strap on dildo. I mean.
Oh, so what do you mean, Blake?
Anyways, I will say, go fuck yourself, 365 Flicks Podcast, because they are not saying, I think Blake is a better diva than me. I think that's what they're saying.
They're saying Blake is a better diva?
I think that's what it was implied. It was implied. I was a little hurt. They liked your fucking Pez comment.
Yeah, granted, I know he's a Pez diva, but seriously, Jay?
I'm not a diva.
You're such a diva.
Really?
I'd only stay in hotel rooms if there's a lobby to it and you don't have to go to the outside. I'll never go camping.
If they put chocolates on my pillow. When did I become British women? British woman.
I became such a Creole female. That's all I do declare.
That you do. Come on down to my bakery. I got some biscuits and some muffins. And this is according to Deb from the Snake Oil Comics. Under the sea. Everything's better under the sea. That's my Crayola. There you go.
Thanks, Def.
Yay.
I still am holding out hope for the audiobook. For
that was Creole?
Yeah, that was Creole.
That was Creole.
Right?
Nowhere close.
Some chicken gumbo.
I do declare. I said I do declare.
Okay, Southern and Creole are not the same.
Aren't they? Go to the next question. Randall Holt.
At RJ Holt 666. He's not evil. He's just handled that way. He said, did any of you watch Scream Queens? He liked it.
I have not seen it.
It was on my DVR, but I have not watched it yet. I do apologize.
I elected to banish it because that was the only damn commercial that kept playing during my download of Wayward Pines on demand watch.
That's because
I kept watching 1,000 Scream Queens commercials during my Wayward Pines. Because when you download on demand, you cannot fast forward the fucking commercials.
You should have DVR'd it when it was first on.
I should have.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Smarty Pants.
Thank you.
That's the problem with watching things like online or on the network apps is you get very limited commercials.
Yeah.
And not on Spice Channel. Spice Channel doesn't have it.
I don't have the Spice Channel.
That's a porn channel. Anyways, no, I will watch it by next week. I do apologize. I do declare
may
I will
or may
watch
not
it.
Watch it.
I will.
I don't know.
I'm intrigued by it. Jamie Lee Curtis. So, next.
From Nicola, graphic novice. Did you watch Blindspot? What did you think of it?
Well, I guess we're just going through all fall TV right now.
Almost. That's what everyone's
asking. Did anyone else watch Blindspot?
I did watch Blindspot.
Tattooed
Blind
chick
yes.
that doesn't know who the hell she is, but she's...
Jamie Alexander is awesome.
Isn't there another show that was similar to that?
Mm-hmm.
Person didn't know who the hell they were, but they had tattoos all over their body?
No. I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh, no, that was Jailbreak. That was the guy that
Prison
wanted
break.
To get himself into jail because they had tattoos all over his body.
Yeah,
he had, out.
He had the map tattooed on his body to get out of jail.
Like when they're hosing his ass down before they get in there, they don't stop and go, hey, what is that?
No, but it was cleverly hidden within the tattoo. It wasn't just a big blueprint on his back. Or maybe it was. I don't know. I never actually watched it.
I was going to say, hey, wait a minute. Did you watch that shower down scene?
I assumed it wasn't just a big blueprint.
There was a tunnel down by his groin area. It was kind of awkward, the tattoo. Did you like Blindspot?
I have mixed
feelings.
Well,
how did you see it?
the premise is a little ridiculous, but then the way it was written, the story, it felt like it's very contrived. Like, every week it's going to be, oh, look, this tattoo will lead us to save somebody else or stop another terrorist attack. And I don't know, it just feels like they're going to do this for a couple of years and then have a very uneventful end.
I would agree with you up until I saw an interview right before we came on the air that the creator of the show said he actually has a 3-year blueprint laid out. And he said the reason is because when he went into the studio, everybody's like, well, that's great for the first 10 episodes. What do you got for, you know, the rest of it? So he's like, I came up with a 3-year plan. And then after that, I have a way that we can go somewhere else with it. I feel a little bit better that the guy has an idea. With that being said, I thought
to come up with it on the spot.
Yeah, I got 3 years. Yeah.
I have a feeling the idea will disappoint.
My issue is that Jamie Alexander did really good.
Yes.
I like her.
I'll agree with that.
I don't like the main guy co-star, or the co-star.
Yeah,
the guy.
I agree.
I thought he was awful.
Yeah, I don't know. Was he trying to smolderly emote or something?
I don't know. Hello. I have an issue with him.
Maybe he'll get better.
Supposedly they add more people on last night's episode to the team.
Okay. Yeah, I haven't seen this.
I didn't either.
Episode.
I haven't seen it yet. I did have, like I said, I am okay not watching anymore, but I think I will give it maybe 2 more episodes just to give it a chance.
Oh, I'll give it, watch a couple more episodes before I make a final decision.
On the other other side of that, anyone see Minority Report? I know you saw the first episode. Did anyone see the second one yet?
No. I purposely banned it because it reminded me of Tom Cruise every time.
Okay. They said the rating, it was the lowest premiered of all the new shows this year so far. And they said it's one of the lowest that they've ever had on Fox in the last, like, 5 years. So I don't think it's going to get renewed.
Oh, I don't know. With Fox's...
It may not even make it through the season.
No, it's not going to.
With Fox's record of not canceling low-rated shows...
That is true.
Oh, wait, no. They cancel everything unless it's American Idol.
No.
And that's being canceled now.
Enlisted. No, they said... The first week's episode was one of the lowest. I don't think they have the second week's in yet. They did say Blindspot, though, did get renewed for 8 more episodes. So that's a whole season, basically.
Oh,
pick
okay.
Up.
They had the original and they got 8 more or something like that.
12 or 13. And then I think they got the back end now.
I'm just jealous. I wish I had this much time to watch new TV shows.
I kind of binge-watched late last night. I watched Heroes Reborn and Blindspot just for this show. Dedication.
Right, there you go.
So...
Proper prepping.
Anyone else like the Muppets? Did anyone see the Muppets?
I saw the Muppets.
I saw the Muppets. I really liked the Muppets.
I saw the first episode.
It was okay.
I laughed out loud a couple times.
Mm-hmm.
There were a couple times where I went, oh, man.
Yeah.
But I didn't see anything that was grossly offensive or mother should be boycotting it.
I watched it with my son.
What are you talking about? The bear and a human are dating. How is that not offensive to you?
I do have to say the best joke was Fozzie saying he was a cuddly bear online and he got a lot of different responses than he expected. I'm nothing against that. It's just not for me.
And wasn't there like a bear shit in the woods joke that he
did? Yeah.
That was pretty funny.
Where are they going to go to the bathroom?
That is an offensive stereotype. I did like it. My son watched it with me. He liked it. I wasn't blown away by it, but anything that keeps the Muppets on TV, I'm fine with.
I think, you know, it wasn't perfect, but I think they've got room to grow. You know, you need to find your footing and find out what's working. And I mean, most shows start out that way.
Somebody did say, reminded that, I think it was Nikki at Puma Zeeley.
Yeah.
She did state that it reminded of her of After Lately, the Chelsea Handler show that they kind of did a sitcom on. After Chelsea was on.
That's
what I had Elizabeth Banks this past week, didn't
it? Yeah, it did. Yeah. I did feel like when she threw Scooter out of the cart.
That was pretty funny. I like that. That was pretty good.
Whatever he says, your assistant hit me first.
I did like the line, though, when it's like, you went into a room full of dancing stars, and the best you come up with was Tom Bergeron?
I'm right here. I'm still here.
I haven't even made it to the elevator yet.
That's pretty funny. I like that.
I liked his story. That was it. That was it. I thought you were going somewhere else with it. And sorry, Million Moms, I know that you guys are assholes.
But if you're listening to our little old podcast, go ahead and ban us.
Yes.
Because we need more listeners.
Yeah. Give us some publicity, Million Moms. But they were saying that they didn't like, you know, a lot of sexual innuendo and some of the jokes in that. Shocking, what happened? My son, he didn't get any of them. You know why? Because it was adult jokes. He didn't understand them.
Well, he didn't exactly understand the Fozzie Bear, no. Cuddly Bear online reference?
No, no.
But the Muppets have always been, even back when it was the Muppet Show, they were kind of more adult skewed.
Oh, yeah, they were always on the...
And now that has changed. I mean, more adult now is, you know, Kermit saying hell, you know.
Did you see the band leader, Mr. Tooth?
Dr. Teeth?
Dr. Teeth, sorry. I guess in this one, sorry.
Oh, yeah. Ooh.
Mr. Tooth.
Tonight's episode, I saw the promo for it. He's like, yeah, I'm selling these cookies to these guys, and they're pretty happy. And Kermit's like, yeah, they're now happy, what, legally?
Legally, yeah.
Legally, they're happy now.
Yeah, the best part is they still have the two cranky old critic guys.
Yes.
That's awesome.
And Janice was there.
Janice was there.
Janice's voice was different.
It was different.
Yeah, I didn't know that. I realize they have to change it, but it wasn't anywhere close to what Janice is supposed to sound like.
I've always been a fan of Scooter, so I like him. Yeah. I like him. I have no issue with that. Was Ralph there? Yeah, he was.
No.
Ralph was with the band.
Was he?
No, Ralph's going to own like a bar across the street.
But there. I thought when the band, I thought he was with the band.
Ralph?
The dog?
The dog that plays the piano?
Yeah. Was he with the band? I don't know.
No, he was never with the band. He was separate.
No, he wasn't with the band, but I think on the
show. I missed it then.
I just read that he's going to own like the nightclub or bar across the street.
Okay.
Where they're going to hang out.
Or maybe I just saw a picture that had everything in it and he was just sitting up with the
band. I enjoyed it. I mean, go ahead. Sorry, Blake.
Oh, go ahead.
I enjoyed it. I didn't think it was the greatest thing, but like I said, it's the Muppets and I'll watch it anytime.
The only thing I found offensive where I actually thought, and I said, you know, this really offends me, was the fact that they had Imagine Dragons on there as the music.
Imagination Dragons?
Yeah.
You know, that was their first, that's what they first thought they were going to name their band. What did they name their band? Imagine Dragons. Go ahead, Blake. Next.
All right, next.
Pam.
We're on Pam Morris at Pam World. Not to be confused with Wally World.
Or Bobby's World.
Or Bobby's World. Or West World. All right, so episodes 1
Jurassic
through 40
World.
Are done. I really enjoyed Jeff Morris's ghost stories at the end of episode 40.
That's the ones from the Paranormal Fest last year? I do have some sad news. It has been rescheduled. They had canceled this year.
Well, not rescheduled.
Well, they said they're doing something next year, so.
Yeah, well.
Wait, hold on a second.
What? Paranormal Fest is canceled this year?
Yes.
Because they knew we were going to be judges of the
I think they were. I was a little upset.
I was looking forward to that.
Morris is going to be back next year. Or next week. Next week, sorry.
He'll be on next week?
Yes, he'll be on next week, so he'll tell us the scoop. But, yeah, unfortunately, so he said next year, so we...
Paranormal Fest, canceled. But why? Lack conflict? Scheduling?
There was a scheduling conflict, I think. Yeah. So, I don't know. I wasn't in charge. I was just going to be a judge.
I know. I was disappointed.
I know. We could have our own costume contest here.
I'm going to be the...
Who's dressed as Slave Leia?
Yes.
Doug?
Yeah. Yeah. I'll do Naughty Schoolgirl, but not Slave
okay.
Leia.
Okay, you have standards.
That's going to be the
I'll
pinnacle
dress
of my Java
so
career.
Slave Leia can be chained to me.
Your blow-up doll? Okay, good call.
A blow-up doll chained to you? You dress Java that actually
or maybe we'll get one of those little
costume.
Pop dolls of Slave Leia. And...
No, that's kind of creepy.
That's my Java with Leia here.
Yeah, raptor arms?
Yeah. Java just got smaller arms.
Can we go on next question?
Just make sure if it's a slave land, make sure it's got the one with the awkward open mouth.
Next!
Anyways, all right, so here we go. So she also wants to know, she just finished watching Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and she loved it. Can't wait for more. What do you suggest I watch next? She says, well, I'll tell you to avoid Wayward Pines.
So Wayward Pines is what you should watch next.
But you can watch the first three episodes and then stop and leave the rest of your imagination because that'll be fucking better than the next 7 hours of the show.
Pam, watch Wayward Pines. It's good.
So I'll say Daredevil.
Oh, that's a good one. That's a good one. Doug's seen two episodes.
No, I'm up to like five or six.
Okay.
Yeah, oh, so you're about where I am then.
Like, yeah, you haven't watched the whole thing?
I haven't watched the whole thing.
Yeah, no, I've watched Daredevil because he can't
see it.
Exactly. Hey, where's my snare drum?
Oh, sorry. Get up. Get back up, Nick.
Thank you.
Do you like it, Doug?
Yeah, but is Kingpin going to be one of these good guys that become, you know, that
no.
really bad? Okay.
He's a bad guy.
Because, like, in, what was it, the Spider-Man movies, you know, Doc Ock was, he wasn't a bad guy, it was the machine.
Yeah.
And the Sandman. He was just doing it to save money. It was like, can't we just have bad guys?
Let's not talk about fucking Sandman, okay?
I'm just, you know, and that's what, where I'm at, that's what it's like.
Fucking Sandman.
Okay, is he good, but...
I tried to save Uncle Ben. Fuck you, no you didn't, it's not even in the books. Shut the fuck up. God. Go back to your airplane in Connecticut, lol. Moving on.
Not bad, just
Massachusetts.
That way.
Massachusetts. Moving on. Sorry.
Moving on.
Daredevil is a good pick. Wayward Pines.
Yes. So, you know, I'm just wondering if somewhere out there in the world our show actually gets transcribed for people who are deaf and heard the Daredevil joke and probably thought, the hell's fucking funny. All right, anyways. Doctor number one.
Oh, long way for that one.
Regarding top five liars.
Liars.
How could nobody pick the Playboy Mansion?
That is a good one.
Yeah, but it wasn't like...
It was fictional.
It was fictional layers. Playboy Mansion's a real...
I've never been there, so it's fictional to me.
Well, it's not fictional to me.
You've been there?
Yes.
Oh, good. You and David Spade?
No, David Spade's not allowed.
Oh, well, that doesn't surprise me. That doesn't surprise me at all.
Just walk around so many Larry Flint Hustler store. Pretend it's the same thing.
What are you guys doing over there?
When you go find your slave Leia with the awkward open mouth.
We got her over there! Right next to the bullwhips.
There you go, son.
There you go. Where's Courtney Love?
You want to go to the dressing room and try that on?
I'm not a creepy old man. I'm just creepy. I'm old too. Never mind. I am. People think I'm smart. Sorry.
Woody Harrelson played me in my movie.
Eddie Redman played me. Yes, he did.
Is that your Creole accent?
I do declare. And thank you to 365 Flicks Podcast for liking my Stephen Hawking's impression. Yeah. Jeff was part of the games this Saturday night that we all played, and I did half the games in Stephen Hawking impressions.
Yes, it was so much fun.
I made a comment like, "Hey, even 365 likes them," and he's like, "I think they're being sarcastic." I don't think so. So the rest of the time, yep.
The rest of the night, he played the game speaking in Stephen Hawking voice.
I did.
And you gave every wrong answer possible, right?
Maybe. Okay, moving on.
Hey, we got two face-offs tonight.
Okay.
Hey, face-off from Doctor Number One.
Face-off.
Tag team division, Laverne and Shirley versus Thelma and Louise.
I want to take their face off.
Well, I will come out right out and say Laverne and Shirley would kick Thelma and Louise's ass.
I would have to agree, because there was an episode where Laverne and Shirley were professional wrestlers. So hey, Laverne could kick some ass.
They were tough girls from the street. You remember them when they were introduced on Happy Days? Laverne was a tough bitch.
Yes.
Yep.
You did not mess with Laverne.
Thelma
and Louise, they were all scared and, oh, I'm so worried.
I think they were caught up in that momentary insanity.
Is there weapons allowed, like guns? Because Thelma and Louise would win.
Yeah, but they couldn't even use their gun properly. They just killed one guy,
Brad
and he
Pitt.
Deserved it. But they didn't kill Brad Pitt. He just stole their stuff and
ditched him
in the hotel room.
That's right.
But there'd be outside interference from Lenny and Squiggy.
There would be.
Oh, Carmen would come in.
Like that's it. Right.
The big ragu.
You could make a six-man tag with Charlie's Angels. They could get in here.
Well, they would win.
Mm-hmm. You think?
Yeah. Oh, Charlie's Angels would win.
Because Charlie's Angels knows television karate.
It's true.
I know. All that.
But then you
stuff.
Could get the new female A-Team in here that is going to be remade. There's Did you hear that?
No.
Yeah, they're making the A-Team, and I think they're doing females, all females.
TV show.
And I have no problem diversifying at all. I get that, you know.
So who's going to be the Hannibal? They're going to call her Catherine the Great or something?
I don't know. I think Melissa McCarthy's in it.
They're just going to call her Hannibal?
Sure. It's Kristen Wiig. No, just ignore me. Anyways, they shit in a sink, okay?
Oh, like, she pooped in a sink? Oh, I'm going to go see it. Yeah,
it's awesome.
And we're going to give her an award. Yeah. Best shitting in a sink comedy scene.
And I do have to...
So is she going to win the floppy this year?
Best impression of somebody shitting in a sink.
There you go.
What's her name? Melissa McCarthy?
Melissa McCarthy.
Melissa McCarthy? And Melissa McCarthy. I think she's going to win. I did have to address Michael Leal. Michael Lee, I think is his real name.
Michelle Leal.
No, that's his wife, actually. He was saying about Supergirl that he was going to mock me when everybody starts loving it and I'm going to be left in the dust. And I said, first off, it's not a good pilot. It could get better. And then somebody chimed in saying, do people just hate this because they, you know, are women bashing? That is not the case. I'm not liking it because it's not a good show. It's not written well. The character is weak. I would love to have a good female-led superhero movie or show. Supergirl is not it. It's not because I hate women. I do not.
Or at least based on the pilot, it is not.
Based on the pilot, it is not a good show. So just because you don't like something that stars a woman in it in the main role does not mean that you're woman bashing. I'm sorry. It's just not a good show right now. So
are you sure the pilot you saw was going to be the pilot?
Yes. It was not good.
Is that your editorial for Huffington Post?
It kind of annoyed me. when, you know. But it did make me feel happy because Michael did say that he really hates me because he's defending an adequate show that he really doesn't want to defend because of me. Because I'm bashing it so hard.
Now, you're saying you don't dislike it because it's a woman in it?
No, not at all.
Okay. Are you disliking it because the Red Tornado's in it? Do you have something against Native Americans?
No.
Is that what it is?
No.
I thought that
it's not Apache Chief.
Red Tornado. I was like, hey, man, this is Apache Chief.
Did you hear last week's episode what the scientist's name is? Dr. T.O. Morrow.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't like Red Tornado because of that. That's the reason. And so, yeah.
And he's red.
No.
All right. Well, you don't like red people, huh?
Stop it.
You don't like the Washington
Redskins. We're done. Moving on. Oh, we ran out of time for face-off with Bobby H.
No, it's our second face-off, Bobby H.
Yeah.
And, yeah, you're right. We're out of time.
And we got a special segment this week. Mark from Tangent Bound Network, who runs a great network. Please go see it. Lots of great shows on there.
See it.
Listen to it. Anyways, he is a prepper. And we were talking, Blake and I, 2 weeks ago about...
Is he a doomsday prepper?
He is. He was talking about Fear of the Walking Dead. Or you and I were, I'm sorry. And we were talking about, you know, just what would you pack to get the fuck out of town. You know,
did he agree that they should have at least turned on the goddamn radio for emergency broadcast? All right, I'll have to listen.
Well, he has a 10-minute segment here about the top 5 things you should do as a prepper to get the fuck out of town and what you should be prepping for.
All right.
He also used to work with a prepping magazine, so he is well-versed in this.
Shit.
Yeah. So Mark would like to come on the show in the future, and we would be more than happy to have him. But first, he has a little prepper segment, so I did not get a chance to make any theme music, but he has a nice little birds chirping in the background, so we're going with that.
All right.
So I can sing it. You want me to sing?
Chirp, chirp.
No, a prepping segment. No? Sure. Okay.
God, no.
Mark, take it away.
Hello. My name is Mark. The guys at the show had asked me if I'd be willing to talk for a few minutes on survival techniques on the go, or prepping for a disaster, or even just bugging out when it hits the fan. There are so many things I could discuss here, and I could go on for hours, but I promise to keep it as short as possible. The example I was given in a Facebook message is that I should talk about the essentials of a prepper, like if you or the family had to bug out immediately. Whether it was an attack of the Walking Dead or Zombievers or maybe Donald Trump won the election and you wanted to get out of Dodge. Whatever your doomsday scenario is, was, or will be, you have to be prepared. Even if it's your significant other throwing you out of the house because you forgot your anniversary. That one time. No matter what the case, here's some helpful info to get you started. Now, if it truly hit the fan, maybe there's two possibilities. Maybe you're away on business and you need to get back to your family. Or maybe you're at home with your family and you need to go. Either way, here are the basics of what you're going to need. First and foremost, there are 4 essentials that any prepper needs. One, food. I think that's kind of self-explanatory. If not, well, you're in worse shape than we realized. Two, water. Again, self-explanatory. Though you may think, I don't need water. I need my Starbucks. I can't live without my double caramel half-calf macchiato with skim milk. Well, I've got news for you. Yes, you can. Number three, shelter. Now, with shelter, it could mean so many different things to so many people. It could be that you need a tent or a lean-to or a car, any place that you can rest your head at night and stay relatively unexposed to the elements. Now, shelter could mean that you have a tarp and some paracord, and there you go. You have instant shelter. Note, some assembly required, batteries not included, side effects may include comfort and warmth. Lastly, number four, protection. Now, again, it could mean a lot of things to a lot of people. Take, for instance, the hardcore prepper. Well, I got guns and lots of ammo. Blammo, I got some 223 protection. Sure, guns are great for protection. But can they protect you from the elements? Protection is a broad term when it comes to prepping. It could mean anything from a gun, a knife, or a sharp stabbing instrument for wild game. Yeah! Or it could mean something as simple as an extra pair of socks or mittens to keep your fingers and tootsies warm. But we'll get into that in a minute. More important than all of those four items is something everyone needs, mental preparedness. You must be mentally prepared for whatever may come your way, especially in a survival situation. Most importantly, the first thing is not to panic. Oh, Lord, what am I going to do without my Netflix if the grid goes down? What am I going to do if I can't get my Starbucks? First, let's break down each of these as to how it relates to bugging out or getting back home. Things that ordinary people don't think about when it hits the fan is, what can I do to ensure my survival if I need to bug out or get back home? The key is to have your basic essentials covered previously. Now that you have all of those, what do you need? Well, first, you have to remember the rule of three. And that goes something like this. You cannot survive more than 3 minutes without air, 3 hours without shelter in extreme conditions, 3 days without water, and 3 weeks without food. Now that you have those teeny little nuggets of information stored nicely in the back of your cerebral cortex, this is what you need. Well, you're probably going to need something to carry stuff in. We in the prepper world like to call that a bug-out bag, or Bob for short. You can call me Bob. You can find bug-out bags online for dirt cheap. Even the ones that come with stuff already in them that's essential for survival. But you don't have the extra cash laying around? Not a problem. You can make one on the cheap. First, get a backpack or a duffel bag that you can easily carry long distances without tiring yourself out by being overloaded with lots of stuff. Next, you need the stuff to put in the bag. Number one, food or means to catch food. So whether it's pre-made or pre-packaged meals or MREs, which, by the way, stands for Meals Ready to Eat. Freeze-dried foods with long shelf life, but still has nutritional value. It's kind of recommended that you have at least 1,000 calorie per day diet. You can find these online or at Army surplus stores or even backpack outfitter stores. If you don't have MREs or storable food with long shelf lives, then you need a way to catch food. If you have a gun, great. Now you can go hunting. Or if you pack a fishing line, lures and hooks, which can also be great for creating snares and other traps for small game like rabbits and squirrels. Number two, water. It's a necessity. No, you can't live off Starbucks. Sorry. If the grid goes down, you're not going to have your double caramel half-calf macchiato with skim milk. Or, in my case, a peppermint mocha. Since the regular human body requires 1 gallon of water a day, you're obviously not going to be carrying 50 gallons of water on you at all times. That's just silly. What you need is a way to consume the water available to you. Though, that doesn't mean you shouldn't actually carry a water bottle. Sometimes you may go long distances without water sources available, and you're going to need a container of sorts, whether it's a canteen or an Aquafina bottle. Will I only drink the finest spring water available? Well, good for you. Get a life straw, and you can drink right from the spring. Yes, that's an actual thing. You can find life straws online or at any camping supply store. They usually run about $20. Reason they're so expensive? Because they filter out all the nasties in unpurified water. They only weigh 2 ounces and can be used to filter up to 1,000 liters of contaminated water into pure, safe drinking water without boiling. Check out life, buylifestraw.com for all of the great products. And before you ask, no, this message is not sponsored by LifeStraw. Although it'd be cooler if it was. Number 3, shelter. If you're driving to where you need to be, your car is the perfect shelter. But if you're stuck on foot, you're going to need something more. Now, you can buy a small tent that can comfortably sleep 2 people, or you can buy a cheap tarp that you could use to make a tent. You'll probably also need a few more things if that's the way you're going to go, like tent strings, tent stakes, or even cheaper, paracord. Paracord has so many awesome uses when it comes to camping and survival. I highly recommend that you carry it with you no matter what. Number 4, protection. While again, it could mean a gun and or a knife, which you should always carry a good fixed blade knife as a rule of thumb when packing your bug out bag.
What about my gun?
Yes, if you have a gun, you can carry that too. Yeehaw! You done? Okay, as mentioned before, some methods of protection are merely protecting yourself from the elements. Think about it. A pair of gloves can go a long way, especially in the cold. I'd even mentioned an extra pair of socks previously. There's nothing more mood-killing than cold, wet, squishy tootsies. Now that we've covered the 4 basics from earlier, let's talk about some of the other things you're going to need. How about first aid? Yeah, you're going to need something to cover that boo-boo you're bound to get when cutting the paracord to make your makeshift tent. Pack a halfway decent first aid kit. Band-aids, bandages, alcohol wipes, which, by the way, have more uses than sterilizing wounds. Medical tape, suture kit, if you have one, great. An ice pack, maybe a heating pack or two, because if it gets cold, those are great to stick in your gloves. Let's not forget tweezers for removing splinters or bee stingers, etc., etc., etc. Now, if you're allergic to bees, you're probably going to want one of those treatment kits as well. Scissors are great for many things, especially in first aid. One more thing that people overlook in the first aid department is aspirin. Small painkillers are a must. If you can't have aspirin for whatever health reasons, try Tylenol or ibuprofen or Motrin, etc., etc., etc. Motrin is great as a fever reducer, just in case.
Whoa, it's hot in here!
Now, how about personal hygiene? Just because you're surviving doesn't mean you have to reek. Pack a travel toothbrush, maybe some of those dental toothpicks, or some biodegradable soap. Cleanliness is also key to good survival. You get a wound, you want to keep it clean. Not to mention, it's a real morale booster when you feel fresh and clean. Now, how would you like your food prepared? Answer? Cooked. First, you're going to need a way to start a fire. While you can take 2 sticks and rub them together, you're probably going to want to have a lighter or waterproof matches or even a flint and striker. I've got a few of these items in my bug-out bag, and they make life so much easier on the go. Just a few minutes ago, I had even mentioned alcohol wipes. Those things are great fire starters. So, now that you have food, water, shelter, protection, first aid, and fire starters, what more could you possibly need?
Starbucks.
I'm going to slap you. How about a flashlight? Travel Kleenex? Batteries? Pocket poncho, duct tape. Believe it or not, duct tape is useful in so many ways. Like that time she started yelling at you for forgetting her anniversary. That one time, which led to this whole survival situation on the go thing in the first place. I digress. Maybe a portable wind-up radio to stay in the know. What about camping silverware or a mess kit? A can opener, a compass, you need to know which direction you're headed. If you're going to a specific location, you're going to need to know which direction to head in. Maybe a fold-up map to go with that compass. You'll need to know where you're at, and, you know, why not? How about a sleeping bag or a solar blanket? A solar blanket is great for keeping the heat in. Not to mention, you could use it as a shelter. Because, think about it, if you don't have a tarp, That solar blanket works great as the keeping the wind off of you in some of the weather. It's actually pretty cool. So, maybe you want some of those Leatherman multi-tools. Or one of those. I mean, you know, those things come in handy. Super glue, maybe one of those camping shovels. Ooh, what about a signal mirror? Maybe some extra ammo if you happen to have a gun with you. If you have a family to look after, make sure your spouse or significant other has the necessities that they need. Make sure that they have their feminine products, if that is one of their necessities. Which, by the way, believe it or not, and this is going to sound funny, but tampons have a fantastic survival use. And not just for saving your sanity, if your significant other happens to forget them. They work great for fire starters, first aid, minor water filtration, and more. Just make sure they're not used first. If you have small children to look after, make sure they have all the big-time items that are necessary for them as well. Maybe formula, extra diapers, you know, the big necessities. Also, the thing that you can fit into your bug-out bag, I mean, you can have baby bottles, you can have formula, all this stuff, especially the powder formula, because that is perfect. And after you've filtered your water or boiled it or what have you, it makes for a great bottle for the baby. If you have a baby. Oh, the things you can fit into a bug-out bag. Those are just a few of the items that you can take with you. Yeah, I said a few items. I encourage you to check out all the possibilities online. Do some research. Find out what works for you. And always be prepared. One thing I've always told people is don't always prepare for doomsday. It doesn't always have to be doomsday. Prepare for life. Having the bare essentials with you daily means that you won't have to go without them long. You know, some people prepare for that doomsday, whether it's economic collapse or what have you. Prepare for life. Prepare for, could be a job loss, could be a tornado, could be a fire, could be anything. Just always be prepared. Doesn't really matter. Anyway, I've taken up enough of your time. My name is Mark, and I approve this message.
Well, thank you for that segment, Mark. Hope everyone understands you're preparing for life. Prep for life.
NWO would say for life. So some good tips in there.
Exactly. I'm a little disappointed he did it outside with all the birds. I was hoping he'd be in his bunker with porn in the background or something.
Maybe the birds are in his bunker. They could be.
Maybe he's eating birds?
Maybe. Gotta do something.
Tastes like chicken.
There's a fish that you can have as a prepper. I saw on Doomsday Prepper that they spawn a lot, like every 28 days, so you can eat them. Like, they spawn a lot.
Salmon?
It's not salmon. It's something.
Goldfish?
No, not goldfish.
Goldfish. Carp?
Maybe. Maybe carp. I don't know.
Minnows.
Why are you telling me this? I don't know what the answer is. It was something. So the people were doing it, and then I guess the algae that they make or, you know, the thing, you can actually eat if you really got desperate. But it also is, I guess, good fertilizer for your plants, too, that, like the corn and or vegetables that you're growing. So
decent corn.
Yes. My watermelon are coming in. Finally.
Finally.
Yeah, I lost two or three, but now I got a really big melons.
Are you going to have enough to trade VF for eggs?
I don't know. I'm trying to get some chickens from VF. So.
Chickens are just eggs.
Whatever. Whatever.
I mean, I don't think he's, like, breeding chickens.
Well, in my gated community, we're not allowed goats or chickens, unfortunately, so.
So you might as well just go for the eggs.
Well, I did tell my wife I think she would move to 5 acres so I can get a chicken coop, and she said no. And so I was quite disappointed in that. So what else would you do with 5 acres?
Chickens.
Thank you. So,
anyway, so. In your gated community, you should start a big compost mound in your backyard. That way everybody can smell it.
I don't live in a gated community. Of course, sure Nate, you do. Nate at the guard tower.
Yeah, it was good to see him again.
Yeah, it was good. He did buzz me and say, your number one fan is here. I was like, oh, let him on in. So we appreciate Nate.
Yeah, just as long as he doesn't get you confused with Dr. Number One.
Yes.
Because we're trying to keep him out.
Nate doesn't do a good job with Dr. Number One. He doesn't do a good job. Did you eat all the pests?
Almost.
I went to look for more Pez, and you ate them.
It's my Pez, bitch.
And before we get to News of the Geek, just to let you know, Doug had a $25 gift card for us, for our fans. Leave us a review on iTunes or Stitcher, and let us know on Facebook, History of Bad Ideas on Facebook.
Or Twitter.
Tweet us at Bad Ideas Podcast, and let us know that you did a review. We only need about 3 or 4 more. And we'll put everybody into a hat and draw a $25 gift card for iTunes. So there you go. And maybe if you're lucky, maybe you'll get a Tomorrowland Pop figure. I don't know.
Ooh. Or if you
I'm not letting that go. It's expensive. It's going to be worth something.
Or if you go to iTunes and leave us like a big roast of a review, like give us like, you know, 0.5 stars out of 5 and rip us. That counts too.
No. We want 5-star reviews.
Oh, 5-star rips?
Four.
Oh,
four.
Well, we want 5-star reviews, but even if you don't like us, you're still eligible to win.
You're not going to, but you're eligible. Bring that shit to another podcast. The political one down the hall. Okay, so there you go. News of the Geek.
Sure.
It's time for another installment of the News of the Geek.
Deadline reported yesterday, that the longtime production partner to Warner Brothers is going to sell off the rights to 78 of their most precious nuggets of fandom.
Nuggets.
While the libraries of every film are up for grabs, the studio has retained the rights to remake certain properties, and the rumors are that these are the films that they're trying to remake. Ace Ventura, Pet Detective.
Why, God, why?
Major League, the movie.
No, stop it!
Oh, last time the city of Cleveland actually won a championship.
Yeah. Well, they didn't win the championship.
Really. Division, they won the division. That's
they won the division. Yeah. That's about all they did in Major League.
True Romance. And The Exorcist. Exorcist doesn't surprise me. They've done that, six times over?
They tried to do the prequels and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I remember, in the early 2000s, they remade The Exorcist, and it was okay. But
anything else, the studio retains the TV rights and gets a portion of any money made from said remakes. They said the reason they're doing that is, I guess, a lot of their movies have been bombing lately, so they said, why don't we sell off the other ones and just, you know, basically...
Since we can't make anything good, let's just sell off our inventory, and somebody will make something good.
And we can just earn the profits from that.
So does that mean they're worried about how bad Batman v Superman is going to be?
That is not one of them. The DC thing is different.
No. But Warner Brothers is worried of losing a lot of money from...
They're already going to try and recoup the losses.
Yeah. They're hedging their bets.
The week after it comes out, it's up for sale. Just take it. No, I think all they got is that. They did say there was a bad Warner Brothers movie that came out that lost them a lot of money this year. I can't remember what it was, and that was pretty much the reason why they started doing it. So, that's kind of interesting. Does anybody care that we have an Ace Ventura or Major League remake? Can we not do that, please?
Let's not do that.
Major League.
Let's remake it with women.
Oh, I think they did. It's called League of Their Own. Which was a good movie.
Major League worked so well because it was the Indians and they were horrible. And that's
it works well
because... And the Indians are still horrible, so we can move on.
Yeah, exactly. In my older age, as my eyes get bad, I'm gonna get the Vaughn glasses.
The Wild Thing?
I'm going to get the Wild Thing glasses. That's going to be my style, man.
Can you throw a 100-mile-per-hour fastball?
No.
Oh.
I'll pick a third baseman with a hot wife and have sex with her. I mean, if I weren't married.
That's right.
Aren't the Wild Thing glasses just pretty much Drew Carey glasses with a skull and crossbone on them?
Pretty much.
Yeah, birth control glasses. They're BCs. They're called BCs in the military.
Ah.
Birth control glasses.
Because nobody's going to have sex with you.
You're not
going to
get laid wearing these glasses. Although, the military is so great at, you know, not changing things, those eventually came back into style.
There you go.
My question is, with Major League, how can you remake that? Everything they did in that was like first time they ever did something. Like first, you know, every character was, you know, they were in different sports movies, but the
Willie Mays Hayes.
Yeah, all of them were like Dorn. It was such a perfect combination.
It was.
And it wouldn't be funny anymore because you've seen it now already.
Joe Boo. Fuck you, Joe Boo.
I do it myself. So.
Try it.
But let's see what they'll do is they'll just get different characters.
Oh, yeah.
So they'll come together and act differently.
Worked out well for Major League 3.
And then they'll pick some other team that doesn't have that great losing tradition that's not the Indians.
Cubs?
The Browns.
Cubs.
Browns, the football version.
Browns. The football version of Major League?
Yeah, why not? The Browns. Kevin Costner can be GM. He can try to win the thing.
Yeah.
You could do draft day, too.
And then he'll end up drafting Johnny Manziel and screw him over for a couple
homeless guy
years.
Told me to draft Manziel. Do it!
Yeah, that's right. And then you could have, like, Art Modell's daughter who moves the Browns again. There you go.
Could pick somebody from, like, Achille Smith.
It could happen.
Jupiter Ascending was the Warner Brothers.
That's what it was. There's a lot of jumping from what a couple of our fans said.
Jumping from here to there.
Yes.
To everywhere.
Game of Thrones fans.
Yay!
All two of you here.
What, Doug? You're not a Game of Thrones fan?
I don't have HBO, so no.
You don't need HBO. You just need someone HBO Go password.
They have discussed the fans.
This is the best part. We should have Jason read this and quiz him on his knowledge. Like, who is Jon Snow? Why is this important?
Jon Snow is Kit Harington. I know that.
Because he was in Pompeii.
Yeah! I'm going to be an optimist about this. Game of Thrones fans have discussed Jon Snow's alive or dead status, that it was even the fodder for a joke at the Emmys.
Missed it.
But we may have found the best evidence yet that proves the true state of the Lord Commander. Yeah, Jon Snow's the Lord Commander.
Of what?
The Snow family. The Daily Mail. Like, you're the Lord Commander of the Edwards family. Well, no, I met your wife. She's Lord Commander. I know that.
That's right. She's the Empress.
The Daily Mail picked up some paparazzi photos from the Game of Thrones set in Belfast, where Kit Harington...
Hold on. Do you know where Belfast is?
Ireland. Thank you.
Oh, that's pretty impressive. For an American.
Keep going.
What's that part of Ireland?
You thought it was part of Boston, didn't you?
Where Kit Harington is not just hanging around, but actually in costume, complete with a sword hanging by his side. The Mail speculates that a woman under a nearby umbrella could be Carice Van Houten. I think that's Milhouse's mom, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Milhouse's mom.
As Melisandre. That's pretty damn good. Look at that one. Yeah! Fuck you! Oh, who took speech lessons this week? Ooh it, ooh it.
I mean, who read ahead to figure out what he needed to learn?
Oh, like, that's ever helped me. That's ever helped me. Which suits the theory that Melisandre could be responsible for Jon Snow's resurrection. But the photo is so grainy that it's really impossible to tell, so they have no idea.
So, there's a grainy photo. Yay!
Just like a Zapruder film. Jon is no longer wearing the black armor of the Night's Watch, but Stark armor, like Iron Man, suggesting that the former bastard of Winterfell, the zombies, may be rallying the remaining Stark loyalists in a battle against the Boltons, Michael, who are currently rolling the roost in Jon's old home.
That's awesome.
So
you have no idea what all this means.
Yeah, they're attacking Michael Bolton. Nobody fucks with Michael Bolton. Fucking
so Iron Man
Bolton.
Is attacking Michael Bolton.
Yeah, Iron Man. I like this. I like how Tony Stark comes into it.
So
okay.
You should start watching.
No, I'm not going to. So I'm not against it. I just no.
Oh, we should go back, Pam. If you're not watching Game of Thrones, that's what you should be watching.
Okay. Yeah, really.
So, do you guys got anything to say?
I'm still waiting
for. Spoiler alert.
Yeah. Spoiler alert. Yeah.
Spoiler alert.
I think it's pretty much what everybody thought was going to happen anyways.
Yeah.
And I think it just basically confirms that,
I think it's going to be a Jedi ghost.
Oh, that would be cool.
Yeah,
sure.
Well, it's
speaking of Jedi ghosts, mm-hmm. Did you see the rumors about who's coming back?
Hayden Christensen.
Yes.
Hayden Panettiere?
No, Christensen. No. Episode 8.
No. If Hayden Panettiere was going to be in Star Wars, I would say five knuckle yes. But no. Hayden Christensen
will be coming back as
they don't say what? They don't know yet. My thought is he could come back as a clone because in the books they made clones, didn't they, Doug?
Yeah,
of the Emperor and all that.
Or he could be the dead spirit guy with Anakin and Ben and Mark Hamill. Luke's going to be a new spirit guy.
I'd rather have Jake
for his whatever Leia's kids who he trains to be a Jedi, but he dies kind of like how Ben. Got killed by his dad, and then he's going to be with them in the spirit world.
I'd rather have Jake Lloyd as the actor coming back.
Whoopee!
Are you an angel?
So were you somebody who got all upset when word broke that Mark Hamill was going on set for the start filming of Episode 8?
No, I was pretty happy that...
A bunch of people got all upset. Oh, spoiler alert, you ruined the movie. We know he's going to live. I'm like, or he could be a Jedi ghost.
He's going to live. Han's going to die, and then... Luke will die in the 8th or 9th. That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. They gotta do some Game of Thrones shit to kill him off.
Yeah.
Create that dramatic effect.
I'm looking forward to...
Oh, that'd be cool. They kill him all off in the first 10 minutes of the movie.
That would be awesome.
All the returners.
Like Darth Maul,
and it wouldn't even be by the bad guys. It was just like a random car accident. Or a speeder accident.
A land speeder accident. Oh, shit.
I'm sorry, son. Your uncle and your mom and dad died. What?
The land speeder didn't have rollover protection.
Oh, yeah, I was listening to the Musings of a Geek podcast, and they were talking Game of Thrones, and just Will came up with a theory that they'll have, you know, bring Jon Snow back through mystical reasons or whatever, and they'll just trip and fall off a wall and die.
I like it.
Like, they'll bring him back, and then it's like, oh, shit, life happens. Oh, well.
So, Michael Bolton wins, then.
So, Michael Bolton wins.
Okay. Yes, Michael Bolton.
But that's when Michael Bolton from...
Michael Bolton and the Canadians win, yes.
It's the Michael Bolton from Office Space, though.
Oh!
Yeah, they hold Ticonderoga.
Why should I change my name? He sucks. Geek.com listed their favorite foreign objects from the world of wrestling. Here we go.
Yeah.
No particular order.
Oh, I thought this was... Because the first one's the best one.
2x4. Hacksaw Jim Duggan's 2x4. I like the story. His signature foreign object... was credited to Bruiser Brody, who during the rough and tumble territory days told Duggan that if he was going to carry something to the ring, it should be something he could use.
So he brought a 2x4.
Like Bobby Heenan said, she brought a big crescent wrench. Big crescent wrench. Mm-hmm. The urn, like
that was the worst ever.
From Paul Bear from Undertaker.
Paul Bear carrying a
urn. Singapore cane from the Sandman from ECW. They said Sandman probably never would have gotten over, but he did it with the help of the
cane.
Yeah, and his drinking every time he came out. The guitar from the Honky Tonk Man.
Honky Tonk.
And Jeff Jarrett. I love the guitar as a weapon. Doug, do you remember Hart Foundation holding Macho Man on Saturday night's main event?
Yes.
Honky Tonk Man hitting him?
Yes.
That was awesome. Just to let you know, on the new WWE game for PlayStation and Xbox come out next month.
They got a guitar a match?
Well, you can get a guitar in them.
But the match ends on whoever breaks the guitar over the guy's head first.
Ricky Steamboat's in it. That's awesome. It. Yes.
Oh, I thought you were going to say they're going to bring back all the dead wrestlers.
Well, a lot of them are in it. Ultimate Warrior.
Ricky Steamboat.
Yes. No, Steamboat's not dead.
Isn't he?
No, he's not dead. Oh. Andre the Giant's in it. Let's see.
Is Hulk Hogan in it?
No. The Snake... Because they said it caused fearful fits amongst many wrestlers, which is true. I'll give you that. The tennis racket, Jim Cornette's move.
Never liked Jim Cornette.
Oh, I love Jim Cornette. He managed the Midnight Express. Paul Heyman's mobile phone when he was Paulie Dangerously. I don't know about that one. Doug, what do you think?
So that was the big-ass mobile phone. Not the...
Oh, is that Laura's
phone? It was Jeff's phone. It was Jeff's phone.
Yeah, okay.
I heard you got a smartphone coming.
Who told you that?
Oh, I got it. Sources.
Sources?
Huh? Yes. I heard you might be getting a new phone.
It's possible.
Thanks, Barack Obama.
Does that mean we can actually send you emojis now?
Nope.
He banned them.
I'll turn that off.
Let's see. A fork, like Abdullah the Butcher used to fork everybody in the head.
He'd fork everybody.
Go fork yourself. Megaphone.
There I used to go. Like Jimmy Hart.
Yeah.
Jimmy Hart.
Yeah,
he always had that megaphone. That was a lot of fun.
Jim Neidhart's in the new wrestling game too, Doug. The Hart Foundation. Really? Yes. The salt, Mr. Fuji salt. I always liked that one. That was
throwing
pretty cool.
Throwing your eyes and he blamed you. That was great.
I like that one. And it was Mr. Fuji. Head. I thought this was dumb. Al Snow's head.
Al Snow's head. No, but everybody wanted head. They would chant, "We want head."
Yeah, it's dumb. I don't like it.
But they chanted.
You know what's missing on this list?
What's that?
Chair.
A chair?
Yeah.
Everyone uses a chair.
Exactly. Everybody uses the
damn
chair.
You know what's missing on the list is the cookie sheets.
Oh, yes.
Cookie sheets.
We were watching wrestling one time, and they reach under the ring or whatever, and they're like, oh, my God, he got steel cookie sheets. I'm like, why the hell are there cookie sheets under the ring, and why are you calling them steel cookie sheets?
Yeah. I always like when they pick up the steps, and they go, those weigh 300 pounds easily, and they're tossing them like Nerf balls. It's like, I don't think they weigh 300 pounds. They're cheap.
Yeah, no, that's 25 pounds.
Maybe.
Maybe.
I used to work for a sporting goods store.
Did you?
Yes. I think you did, too.
Oh, okay.
And when I was out a little bit further, a different sporting goods store than you, and we were close to Heartland Valley Wrestling.
Yes. Yes. Oh, yeah.
The minors for the WWE back in the day.
The minors.
It was. Minors. You got to learn somewhere. We would have the wrestlers come in, and they would buy sporting goods equipment for their matches that night. Because it was back in the day of the, you know, extreme wrestling all that stuff. We would have Ming.
Folding chairs.
Remember Ming?
Ming.
He's in the new game, too. Haku is.
I hear he's a badass.
Yes. Him and Steve Blackman would come in often and buy hockey sticks. baseball bats, because they would just cup the end of it and that. Yeah. And then, like, other stuff, too, from the hunting department. I don't know, like, lodge, the camping and that. And they would always buy them and bring them up. It was always pretty funny. It was about once a week they would come in, and they would just get a shopping cart full of this stuff, because they were the trainers that down there. So they were bringing it to the rest of their students.
My favorite wasn't Rosie in that a lot?
Yeah, Rosie was there too from 3 Minute Warning.
Okay. Yeah. When he was, I liked when he was the superhero in training.
Yes. Yes. Shit.
Shit. So funny.
The one I see missing from here, and I believe you may have been there. Sold out.
Yes. WCW.
Wasn't it barbecue sauce on a stick?
Yes.
There was a barbecue sauce bottle. Yeah. And that was the foreign weapon.
It's amazing WCW went out of business.
Medusa versus Ed Ferrara?
Yes, who was Oklahoma.
Oklahoma, yes.
Oklahoma, who was a ripoff of Jim Ross, who has Bell's palsy?
Bell's palsy, yes.
Yes, and so they made fun of that, and it was, and nobody laughed, and everybody's like, you're making fun of his disease. That's not very funny, and he's an old commentator. Why are you making fun of the announcer for a different federation? It doesn't make sense.
Oh, they always make fun of each other.
I know, but WCW is so bad at the end. They had Viagra on a pole match.
Yes, yes.
Remember that?
Yes.
No.
Yes, bad. Viagra on
a
pole match.
You know why
match.
They're so bad? Because they brought in WWF writers.
Yeah, Vince Russo.
Vince Russo killed
WCW. I actually watched, there was an hour-long documentary about that on the WWE Network about Vince Russo.
Maybe he was
bad.
Maybe he was a poison pill plant.
That was one of the rumors that Vince McMahon let him go to because he knew he would ruin them.
Or
he was under orders to ruin them.
Yeah. I don't know. Vince Russo has some... He ruined TNA.
Wait. David Arquette was a fine WCW champion.
Yes, yes.
Fine champion. Yes.
Did he ever defend his championship?
I think he did. They said the WCW belt changed hands 16 times in a matter of 5 months.
Wow.
So. This
means there's good competition.
Good competition.
That's what, yep.
Means even field.
Vince Russo and David Arquette were included in those changes.
You know, there are two
Vince
props.
Vince Russo actually won it once?
Yes.
Yeah.
There are two props that are missing from this list. I mean, other than the chair and table.
Well, they said the chair was taken out because of...
Everybody used the chair.
Yeah.
It wasn't any special
kind. Yeah.
But, you know, Rowdy Piper never uses bagpipes to hit anybody, but he would play them sometimes coming into the ring.
He would.
And I think he used his kilt to hurt people.
He did.
He used his kilt to hurt people.
He threw it at them.
He used his TV show to hurt people. His talk show.
Piper's
his
Pit.
Interview, Piper's Pit.
Rowdy Piper.
But the number one...
The number one thing that's missing is the hot chick.
Oh. The distraction. Yes.
The distraction and sometimes the collaborator.
Scary Sherry's stiletto heel. Can we get that in there? Or her purse? The loaded purse? What's in there, McMahon? I don't know!
The best foreign object ever, though, was Cowboy Bob Orton's cast.
He kept on for 3 years?
I thought it was even longer than
that. Might have been. Well, he had a broken arm.
You know, your hot chick would always distract the guy with her looks. Or, like, you know, remember, Elizabeth would help out Randy Macho Man. Or she would, you know, when the refs turned their back, she would do something.
Or Sonny would sleep with them. Oh, allegedly.
Exactly.
I was wondering...
Give them an STD.
Or Stephanie would.
Stephanie.
Yeah. Give them an STD so they can't, you know, perform at their peak. You know?
Where's the Mountie shock stick? Anyone?
Yeah.
Where's the shock stick? That was awesome. The way he did it to Piper, and Piper had the rubber-proof vest.
Rubber-proof vest?
Yeah, so it didn't affect him. It's great.
It protected you against rubber.
Yep. No, it protected against the shock stick.
The rubber-proof vest.
Some quickies. According to ComingSoon.net, Danny Boyle hopes to start shooting Trainspotting 2 in May of 2016.
Meh.
I like the original Trainspotting.
Yeah, but does it need a sequel?
If it's got Kelly MacDonald in it.
I think the book is actually called Porno. I think 365 was talking about that. Let's see. Sony announced no follow-up to the handheld would be made for the PlayStation Vita due to smartphones and their free games.
Makes complete sense.
Yeah.
Well, it does make some sense. Then we go to Nintendo and their new system that comes out next year, which they have not mentioned yet, but they're in talks. The specs came out for it. Some of the specs.
Yeah.
The rumor is that it's a handheld that you can play at home on the TV. It's not really a console. You're going to put the games in the back of it, and then when you come home, it's going to be enough power for the graphics that, you know, it'll be decent graphics like it is now, And you just come home and you can play it right on the TV.
But you can't play it in the car.
You can. Or... You can take it with you. It's a mobile.
Okay.
So it's going to be like a Nintendo 3DS, but the one that you can put up on the TV.
Oh, but it'll wireless to your TV.
Which so actually kind of makes sense.
Yeah. Oh, that makes sense. Yeah.
So if you felt disconnected to your children to begin with.
Now you're going to be disconnected.
Now you're completely disconnected.
Yes.
There you go.
I've been thinking that they were going to go that route, because they've been dropping hints about that for years. Even the Wii U, they were thinking about it. So, I don't know. I like the Wii U still.
One other story. I don't know if you've seen this. Did you see Paul Walker's estate and the guy who was driving his car, driving the car when he died, are both suing Porsche?
Yes.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
Why is it? For safety?
Something like, yeah. There
was... Because when you're traveling at 130 miles an hour, they just weren't safe.
See, they were saying they were only going 71, and there was that...
You still hit a tree.
Something was wrong with the car, and stability control, and traction.
You're still going 71.
In a short amount of time.
Yeah. I can understand Paul Walker's estate. Okay, sure, yeah. We're looking, you know, but the driver?
Yeah.
It's your fault.
Yeah. They wonder why insurance is so high, because of these lawsuits. Anyways, moving on. So there's your News of the Geek.
Wow, it's time to grab your balls of fury. It's Plotlines with Jeff and Jason.
And Blake and Doug. All right, so this week's Plotlines, for those people who are new to the show, Plotlines is where we get a title of a movie and the year it came out, and using our vast brains, try to guess what the plot of that movie is. This week, we are going to do The Man Who Loved Cat Dancing from 1973.
And if you have a movie that you would like to send us, please do. Yes. That we may not see.
This one was brought to us by Jason Brigger, so he is excluding himself from trying to figure out the plot.
The thing that brought it to everybody's attention is I found the description when I was looking for the weirdest titles on IMDb. And it was like, no, I don't want to see the description. Oh, I saw it. So I'm excluding myself from this.
So it is The Man Who Loved Cat Dancing from 1973.
Okay. Doug, you're the guest. Would you like to go first?
No.
What is the plot?
I have no idea.
Blake?
It's about a ballet instructor.
Okay.
Who wants to put on a play with cat-inspired ballet dancing moves.
Isn't that the play called Cats, the musical?
No. Oh, okay. There's no singing in that.
I think they're singing cats. I think they're singing cats.
I'm talking about
ballet.
Yeah, okay. Ballet. You don't sing in ballet. Sorry. You uncultured bastard. But, and it would star... Michael Douglas as Liberace, who wants to put it on.
Michael Douglas is Liberace in 73. Yes. I like it. I think it's going to be starring Gabe Kaplan.
Yeah. Heidi, 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 ho. Wrong one?
I don't know.
Who sings that song?
Cab Calloway?
Ah, that's it.
Blues Brothers?
Oh, wow.
Hardy, 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 ho. Same one, right? They're all same. Like, all of them. Gabe Kaplan, right?
No. That's Cam Calloway.
Everybody with the name Kaplan's got to be a musician, right?
No, he was Mr. Cotter in Welcome Back, Cotter.
Oh, well, wrong one then. Okay.
Hardy, 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 ho.
Okay. I'm saying it stars Gabe Kaplan as a guy who is running some sort of brothel.
Called the Heidi Heidi Ho.
Well, it wasn't until now.
And that's how you tie it all together, folks.
And hijinks ensue.
Okay. That was good. Doug?
Okay. I think I'm going to star Dean Jones.
He doesn't sing Heidi Heidi Ho.
No, he doesn't.
Okay.
And a small town coming of age. Oh, wait, no.
No.
he runs the theater at a small town, and he's putting on a play involving live cats.
Okay. Here we go. You ready? It's the frontier of the American West. Shortly after being released from prison, where he was serving a sentence for murder, Jay Grobert leaves a band of three other men and an Indian named Charlie Bent in robbing a train of its Wells Fargo cargo of $100,000. In their escape from the scene, they are first out of circumstances to take along a young woman against her will who is traveling by herself on horseback. She is wealthy. They can tell that is what it says.
They can tell she's wealthy because she owns a horse.
Although they do not let her go, she vows that she would not tell the authorities about them, as she, like them, is running away. As Jay, the leader, embarks on his next mission to fulfill the reason he stole the money, he has problems with managing the three men, and who are all out for their own selfish needs. Let's see. As Catherine and Jay spend more time together and learn more about what is under the surface, Jay and Catherine start to fall in love with each other. In addition to carrying out Jay's mission, they want to figure out a way to be together in the light of their present circumstances. The investigator for Wells Fargo, named Harvey, has a posse of men on their trail. And let's see. And that was about it. They're in a runaway search. The reason why I picked it is because I love the title.
Well, that's what we need, is the title.
Yes. So
I'm guessing, she's the woman's Native American and her name is Cat Dancing?
I don't think so.
Oh.
But maybe.
I'm just guessing.
Maybe.
I just don't get
the... The short synopsis is Western story about a defiant wife who leaves her husband and take up riding with outlaws. It stars Burt Reynolds.
Mm. I was going to say Burt Reynolds and thought, no, he wouldn't be in this stupid movie.
Sarah Miles. And Lee Cobb.
And Jack Warden. And George Hamilton.
George Hamilton is in it. Let's see. Sarah Miles.
Is George Hamilton tan?
Oh, I'm sure. Sarah Miles was in Blow Up, Hope and Glory, The Servant. Like these magnificent men in their flying machines. That's about it.
What? No!
Queenie. Steaming. What
You're
else?
You're missing the best actor in here.
What?
Jay Silverheels.
Who's that?
Who's that?
What?
Tonto from the Lone Ranger.
I just saw the picture. There you go.
Oh, you're terrible. Who's Jay Silverheels?
I saw it now.
You claim to be a Lone Ranger fan and you don't even know who Jay Silverheels is?
Hardy, 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 ho.
Oh, yeah, he's the guy who sings that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Okay, so there you go. None of you got it right. I'm very disappointed in you.
I'm so angry because I saw the year and I'm like, Burt Reynolds was huge then. But now he wouldn't be in this movie.
So there's your plot lines. We've got one. Send it on over to us at Bad Ideas Podcast on Twitter and on the History of Bad Ideas on Facebook.
It's time for Box Office Bombs.
All right. The box office. Nothing really bombed too big. This week, number one, Hotel Transylvania 2. Wow. $47.5 million in its opening week on a $12 million budget.
Is this the resurgence of Kevin James and Adam Sandler?
I don't think it was a $12 million budget. Let me get that right for you. Oh. I think I screwed up on that one. Sorry.
You did. Stupid intern.
I'll get it.
James fired again.
I'm sorry.
Number two was The Intern. It made $18 million on its opening week on a $5 million budget. I'm surprised that budget was only $5 million with the actors in there. Sure. I figured the acting budget's worth bigger than $5 million.
Yeah, De Niro and Hathaway.
Doesn't De Niro make, you know, $10 million?
Let me make sure I'm right here.
The Maze Runner : Scorch Trials made $14 million, a total of $52 million on a budget of $61 million.
Scorch Trials. That's like a sounds like a movie with a guy with bad diarrhea or something. That's funny.
Everest made $13 million, a total of $23 million on a $55 million budget. That's starting to be a bomb there. $13 million on opening week.
And he's made $80 million total.
Worldwide?
Yeah.
Well, no one cares about it in the U.S., so hopefully you foreigner people out there in the rest of the world are helping the people climb Everest safely.
That's right. Who wants to watch a movie about a bunch of capitalist pricks climb to Everest and suffer in a bad snowstorm?
It's like $50,000 to go up there, too.
Yeah.
I could find a lot of better things to do with $50,000.
Exactly. You could buy Porsches and drive them 70 miles an hour.
And Black Mass made $11.5 million, a total of $43 million on a budget of $53 million. Again, no desire to see any movie about Whitey Bulger.
Okay.
You find anything on your Hotel Transylvania budget?
Still work on it. Keep going.
All right. Well, upcoming this weekend, opening October 2nd, The Martian.
Matt Damon.
Is this the beginning of Oscar season?
It is.
This is the official beginning of the release of The Martian. And that's really, I suppose, the only big name movie coming out.
Is anybody intrigued to see this?
Isn't this kind of like a remake of what's his name, where he's on an island with Wilson?
Yes, it's exactly the same.
Survivor.
Movie.
What is that one?
Castaway.
Castaway with Tom
Hanks.
Bergeron. Except he's not on an island; he's on Mars, which is like an island in space.
Exactly, it's a space island.
Was this a Warner Brother movie they sold off for remakes?
I don't know. Martian.
Ridley Scott's directing it.
No. So he's going to find some alien DNA that eventually leads to Alien.
Oh, budget for a Hotel Transylvania is $85 million.
Oh, that's a little different.
That's a little different.
Sorry. Apologize for that.
Yeah, $85 million. So, yeah, they're not even, they're just halfway there.
All right, and the intern budget, please?
I'll get to that.
Where'd you get your numbers?
I'm finding $40 million for the intern.
$40 million?
$40 million, I'm going with. There you go.
So ignore all our budgets this week.
Budget numbers.
Interns are correct.
After the first two are wrong. Yeah, sure. The other two are correct.
I checked.
Yeah, sure.
That's what Doug does research.
Facts.
Not me, but Doug does.
Just the facts,
man. So, Jeff, would you like to go see The Martian? I'm tempted to this week.
It depends on if I'm available at any given time.
Thinking about going Thursday night. It's 2 hours and 20 minutes.
Ooh, that's long.
Yeah, I know. That's my issue.
That's like almost the entire length of the travel to Mars, isn't it?
Doesn't start till 9. So I'm like, ooh.
So you wouldn't be leaving there till 11:30?
Yeah, so I'm debating.
Past your bedtime.
Well, some of us work. Anyways, I'm just saying. We don't all have cushy jobs.
We don't all work for the government.
That's because you're not a Democrat?
Oh.
He is a Democrat.
And you have a job?
I'm a libertarian, okay? Let's just be real. Anyways.
So you're self-employed.
Yes. Anyways. Yeah, so I'm debating if I want to go see it or not. I'm not sure yet. But if you're interested, Jeff, let me know.
I'm interested, so yeah, let's discuss at a future
time. Buy-sell?
Buy-sell. This week, Robert De Niro.
Now that we know the budget's $40
million. In theory.
Who's buying?
I'd be selling Robert De Niro. He's... No offense, doesn't have long for this world. you don't want to buy this late in the game.
He's still kind of high, so sell high.
Okay. Yeah. He's too high to buy.
Yeah, just time to sell.
Anne Hathaway?
I'll buy Anne Hathaway.
Oh, jeez, calm down there.
Woo! Well, he's got his credit card out, too.
I'd like to swipe that.
Sorry.
Declined. Damn it! How about this one? Declined. How about this one? Declined.
That's the same one!
There's a little joke from Life in Pieces this week, the sitcom that, you know.
Yeah.
Did you watch it?
Watched the first one.
Second one, I like it. I hope
it's better than the first one.
I like the first one.
Then I don't give the second one much hope.
Okay.
Because it was like...
Well, I liked it. The funeral scene was a little annoying.
No, that whole scene was stupid.
Yeah.
But the only one of the four skits I thought was funny was the one when they were dropping the kid off at school. And that was only half funny.
Oh, I liked it. Anyways...
Well, you're wrong.
It was fine. Fuck you. The guy from the newsroom is dating this girl. And his car is breaking down. He moved back home because he has no money. And he goes to swipe... he goes to pay for dinner, and he's like, okay, I got it. So he goes up to the counter to pay for it and swipes it, and she's like, and he's looking, he's waiting for it to see if it gets approved, and that gets approved. He goes, yes! I mean, yeah, that's fine. So I thought that was kind of funny, just with the credit card. Shut up. Anyways. The dinner is cheaper than Anne Hathaway, so.
I might be able to buy the dinner. I just can't buy Anne Hathaway.
Yes. Doug, are you buying Anne Hathaway?
No tip.
No, I don't really like her.
What?
I just, she just doesn't do it for me.
Are you a communist?
No.
Oh.
No.
Oh, man. How about Robert De Niro? Are you buying Robert De Niro?
No.
No.
I don't think he's had anything good out in a long time.
The intern?
Al Pacino did Devil's Advocate. He's pretty close to Robert De Niro. I would buy Al Pacino.
He did the Devil's Advocate 20 years ago.
No, I'm not that old.
Al Pacino. Hooah! Anyways.
On any given Sunday, an inch, a fucking inch.
You're right, Jay. It was only 18 years ago.
Really?
97.
Oh, God. I'm old. Really?
Really?
Oh, God. I saw Charlize Theron's breast that long ago? Damn. Well, Reindeer Games. Did see Reindeer Games with Ben Affleck. He was not the bomb in it. Like in Phantoms.
Oh, I finally saw Mad Max.
And?
You know, Charlize Theron, still hot after all these years, mm-hmm. even with a shaved head and hand missing.
Tom Hardy is not coming back to the sequel.
What?
Yeah.
Although there were times where I did find myself laughing at the plot, because it was actually kind of funny. Some of the things in there is like, this is so ridiculous. Why? But you know, it was basically just one big car chase. It was pretty funny.
They said Tom Hardy and Charlize Theron did not get along on the set. And he is probably taking himself away from the...
Well, it's actually pretty good, because their characters didn't get along very well either. So it was kind of like...
Maybe it was method acting.
Yeah, Mad Max is kind of a prick in that movie.
I have not seen it yet, but I still want to.
Yes, I still have yet to see it.
But it's good. Go get the $1 red box and you'll be fine.
Anybody got hidden gems? Anything? Anything? Wayward Pines?
No. did you see Gotham?
No.
Vegan. How's Gotham a hidden gem? Yes, I did see Gotham.
You can talk about it. Go ahead.
Did you like the Penguin's kitchen scene?
Kitchens.
With the commissioner?
Yes.
Did you like it?
Yes. Yeah, it was very good.
That was pretty funny and really good.
That was good.
Yeah? Okay, all right. Because I talked about it last week. I just wanted verification.
Yeah, I was.
Doug, you were at Cincinnati Comic Con Expo.
Yes.
With me. Your first one.
Because you know, Jim's ticket was...
Oh, so you had Jim's ticket.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Well, you actually had Jeff's press pass, but you know, same thing. So, Robin Lord Taylor was there.
Yes.
A lot shorter.
He's a very tiny man.
He is.
I think I could have picked him up and just kind of shaken him.
But he looked nice. Yes. He looked nice. Ian Ziering, back me up on the love for him.
Yes. Looked like he was enjoying himself. Very interactive with the fans, it seemed like. I almost spent the money to get his... autograph.
My wife was sad.
Looking back, I wish I would have.
I do too.
Yeah.
And you should have. And you should have asked about Tara Reid.
Can you get Tara Reid on the
can
show?
Can you get Tara Reid on our podcast?
No, but I'll
please.
Come on. No. We want Tara.
We need you to bring. You can come, but bring Tara Reid.
I think you have done a promo for us.
Yeah.
Now
for $40.
Yeah.
A couple of the guys I work with, they're into that.
Sharknado.
They've gone to Louisville and that, and they said Burt Ward was actually pretty good.
Really?
They said he was,
snubbed Burt Ward.
I did not get his
autograph. They didn't particularly care for Adam West.
I've heard he's been a diva.
He's been a diva for the last 50 years.
His assistant was like, can't do this, don't touch him, don't look at,
We were not allowed taking pictures when he signed in on my autograph.
And I understand, but they said Burt Ward, you had to put your name on it. And, he's like, it was just to Michael, Adam West.
Yes.
It wasn't anything.
That's what mine was.
Yeah, to Jason.
Right.
Now, I understand having to put your name on it.
I agree with that because it stops the collectors that are selling it.
I've got my boss likes to collect stuff. He likes getting sports signatures and stuff. And he bitches being Reds fans that Randy Myers of the Nasty Boys fame will only sign your name. And he's so pissed off at that because he wants to get the money and gets the signature to sell it.
And I understand that people collect autographs and that. My thought is, though, if I'm not meeting them face-to-face...
What's the point of him?
What do I
autograph?
Care that right. I have this ball autographed by somebody?
Right.
I don't get that aspect of it. Now, that's fine if that's your thing. No big deal. My thing is, though, I'd rather meet the person and get his autograph so...
Autograph is just a memory of the meeting, not necessarily some guy once signed this piece of paper and it eventually got to me.
Last year I got Matt Fractions from Hawkeye. He does Sex Criminals. One of the biggest writers out there right now of comic books. And he signed my Hawkeye number one to Jason. Actually, he put Jason because it's an inside joke because in Hawkeye it says Hawkeye in it. Okay. One of the characters always says it. So he asked if I wanted to do it. So I was like, sure. And then he realized that I actually read the book. So he wrote it like that. And he had an arrow drawn on the cover and that. And somebody at the thing said, oh, that's not going to be worth anything anymore. Because there's your name. Who the fuck cares?
Yeah, it's worth more to me.
I have it framed and it's awesome.
Yeah.
It's like, what do I care?
I didn't get it signed to be worth something.
Yeah, and was it Phil Hester that got my Green Arrow from Kevin Smith book? He signed it with my name on the inside cover, and then he did a sketch of Green Arrow in the inside cover. I'm not selling that. It's like, why would I? So, I don't know. I don't get the whole buying autographs, you know, when you don't meet them.
I agree.
So, Doug, did you buy anything?
Who's that autograph from the football farm?
Marvin Lewis, that was a gift, actually. Okay. That was a gift. Marvin Lewis, head coach of the Bengals. That was actually a gift from somebody.
Yeah, that's Marvin Lewis's signature?
Yeah.
It looks like he signed it Mofo.
It does. It looked like Mofo.
So from now on, Marvin Lewis will be known as Mofo.
I met him, though. I was this close to him. I was this close from me to you, Blake.
So you met him?
Yeah, I did meet him.
Did you talk to him?
That was years ago. Yeah, I talked to him. I said hi. And then,
all right, so it was at a charity event. Autograph.
Us people in the gated community go to charity events, so it's okay.
He was supposed to go to a charity event for my wife's work, and he bailed out because he
couldn't. Well, this was 10 years ago when they sucked, so that's why he was there at this one.
So he didn't rub up against you?
No, I kept rubbing his back, though. Come on.
Did I ever tell you my Michael Stipe story?
No.
I met Michael Stipe in Athens, Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we'll save that for another story time.
Okay. Did he rub your back?
No, it was weird.
Did he rub your front?
No, he rubbed my right side.
Moving on. Okay. Great story.
I will still tell it later.
Okay, so Doug, did you enjoy it though?
Yes, yes. It was interesting. I didn't know most of the people there, but it was.
You know Ian Ziering though.
Yes. Okay. And the bald guy from
Steve
Top Gunnimer? Gun.
Oh, Top Gun.
What, Michael Ironside?
Top.
Oh, no, it was the bald guy, the old man.
Yeah.
The guy that yelled.
That yelled what?
I don't know.
Was he the ship commander?
I think he was
the
ship, yeah.
Oh, with the cigar.
Oh,
yeah. Where you can't smoke inside ship spaces, but he had a cigar anyways.
Yeah. I thought it was funny
because the guy who's at the very beginning and the very end.
I think so.
Okay.
He's been a long time. But he's been a lot longer. But it was funny because it was like.
What was he there for? Anything in particular?
I have no idea.
I'm just trying to think what geek thing he would have been related to.
He's been in stuff other. He's been in other stuff before.
What's his name?
James Tolkien.
That's who it is.
Yeah.
All right, what else is he in?
Iron Eagle? No.
Back to the Future.
Oh.
Was he the teacher?
He was the principal.
That's right.
Masters of the Universe.
Yep.
Was he Skeletor?
He was the chief of police. He was the detective.
In Masters of the Universe?
Yeah.
He was Detective-o.
Yes, he was. Investigator-o.
Investigator man.
Got a fist. Make sure we call him
Mr. Fisto.
Sounds good. So, okay, well, there's your thing. No other hidden gems? Okay, let's move on to top five.
All right, top five music means top five list. This week we are going with top five favorite sports moments.
Just your favorite ones.
Yeah, that's fine.
Doug, you can go first.
Okay, now, four of the five I did, I was actually there.
Okay.
One, I didn't.
Okay.
But
it's similar to the rule that I had. I had to actually see it as it happened.
You know, I was going to pick all four Patriots Super Bowls, but I figured Chase would put that on there, so I didn't do that. But
Deflategate was number one for me. Loved that moment.
You were there?
Yes.
But the Boise State Oklahoma Fiesta Bowl.
Oh, God.
I was up at night, 2007, I believe, watching it, going, oh, my God, I can't believe this game. Everybody else was asleep. Our other brother was awake. He's like, I was watching you, too. I'm like, you should have called me. It was just fantastic. They had gone up. Oklahoma had scored 25 unanswered points at the end. Jared Zabransky threw a pick six with a minute left. They did a hook and ladder play to come back to tie it. You know, they did a Statue of Liberty play
to get a 2-point conversion.
They did a halfback pass to get the touchdown in overtime. It was fantastic.
And that's the one where Boise State beat Oklahoma?
Yes.
Yes.
Adrian Peterson was on that team.
Oh, wow. I remember it vaguely, yes.
Every that's the first thing I bought on iTunes because I'm cheap and, buy a lot on it, was the condensed version of that game, and it's on all my stuff.
Okay.
Right.
Now.
Right.
James,
Awesome game.
Awesome.
Awesome game. Awesome game.
Yeah, that's what's his name.
Was that Tom Brenneman?
Tom Brenneman.
Tom fucking Brenneman. Worst sports announcer.
I think that's
the
Tom Bergeron.
No. I'd rather have Tom Bergeron.
I like Tom Brenneman.
I think he's terrible.
He's better than Joe Buck.
Well, he did say about Tim Tebow, if you spend any time with Tim Tebow,
your life is better for
your
it.
Life is
oh,
better.
Fuck that.
Yes.
So Adrian Peterson was in that game.
Yes.
Is he the only NFL player that's still playing from both those teams?
Probably.
I'll research.
That's a good trivia question for next week. There you go. There's your listener feedback for next week. Listener feedback. Question to me. question to myself.
Blake, your number next.
Yeah. Those are, first rule is I had to have seen it. And then that was after I rejected the most horrible, disappointing Cleveland sports franchise moments for like Browns, Indians, Cavs. You know how it works. So there'd be no Elways.
No Golden State.
No Elways. No ball between Tony Fernandez's legs. No, Michael Jordan shots. Whatever. Anyway, so these are the good ones.
It was actually off Tony Fernandez's side.
Off to the side, thanks. I've tried to block it out.
I almost put that on my list, so I looked it up to rewatch it.
Had to block it out. Or we could talk about, Joe Montana drives at the end of Super Bowls.
We could talk about that, but too. That ain't going to make my list
either. That ain't going to make your list? No, but it may make mine now, bitch! No, I'm kidding. 2008 Beijing Olympics. U.S. Women's National Soccer Team beats Brazil in overtime.
That was on mine. That was my number one.
We know that's not true.
We know that's not
true. For a second, I saw the glimmer of hope in his eyes. Like, really?
Wait a minute. This is you.
Jason's asshole about
soccer. You're like, who the hell is FIFA? Yeah, anyways.
It's a game. We talked about this last week.
Right, it's a video game with, Alex, what's her name?
Lawless.
Morgan.
Alexei Lamas.
Alexei Morgan Lawless.
Whatever.
The hot red-haired man chick.
Tony Miola.
Okay, that was your next thing. That's 2008 Beijing Olympics. We got
all right, Jay, you're number five.
That stopped our gold medal drought or something like that.
Were you actually there at the game?
I watched it.
Oh, okay.
What was the final score?
I don't know.
1-0?
We won.
Thriller. Number five for me, just because it pisses off all the people I know that are UK fans. Duke beating UK on the Christian Laettner.
Christian Laettner footstep?
Yes.
That's my number one.
I'm a Duke fan. And so I've always been a Duke fan. Doug, do you remember growing up, I had that big bright blue Duke jacket?
I remember growing up, you were a front runner.
No.
Any chance the team was doing good.
No.
I'm a Cowboy fan.
No. You, I'm a Niners
ever
fan.
Ever claimed to be a Cowboy
fan.
He was young, but he was
you're
a front
Steelers
runner.
You're a Steelers fan.
No, God, no. Never a Steeler.
Yes, I do.
You're a Yankees fan.
That's an awful jacket looking back. How bright and shiny it was.
Ruined my number one. I'm going to have to adjust my list.
Put it on the board. Nope. Put it on the board. That was the greatest thing ever because it always ticks off UK fans.
Oh, to this day.
Yes.
And they're the worst sports fans in the world.
They could be 3-29 for the season in basketball, and they would be upset they're not in the tournament. So,
We got snubbed. Actually, it should be, we got snubbed.
I reckon. Okay. Jeffrey's number five.
My number five was...
my sister, who's my wife, says, Steven says, we got snubbed.
I reckon.
I'm going to go have sex with my cousin.
And my wife. Same
We're
person.
We're UK fans.
I reckon. Number one, lick a frog.
SEC. SEC.
Good, Jeff.
No, go ahead. I just want you to finish.
We're done.
Okay.
We're done.
Until I start talking, then you're going to...
We're done.
Actually, can you do a female Creole UK fan?
I know the crap.
No, he can't.
He can't do it. He can't bring himself to do that one. All right. All right, Doug, what's your number four? Go.
My number five
go, Jeff.
Is the soccer goal that I scored in sixth grade.
And it wasn't doing personal, but I guess you can put it on there.
That's a moment.
Yeah. That's right. So was it a VHS tape?
It's not on tape anywhere.
What? Time out. You said sports moment. I've seen Jeff play sports. That's not a sports moment.
It is for me. No, I'm bad. Right, it was the only goal I scored in my entire 6-7 years of playing grade school soccer.
Yeah.
And it was like the last year I played. So I scored a goal and thought, I don't need to play anymore.
Better than my wife's team a couple years ago. About 10 years ago, they were the bar team, and they scored on their own goal a couple times.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. Happens a lot.
I didn't do it. It wasn't an own goal.
I thought Jeff's best sports moments were all the beams he takes to his head for pitching softball.
I don't remember those.
He doesn't remember those.
Hey, we took two off the head.
Tournament champs.
Yeah, that's right. We are. I almost wore that t-shirt tonight.
Default.
That's right.
Default.
Number four, Jeff?
My number four was Game 6 of the 1990 NCLS National League Championship Series.
Glenn Braggs
robbing the home run from Camilo Martinez to keep the victory, and
that was an honorable mention for me. I was thinking about that one.
My roommate was from Pittsburgh, and we're watching that, and oh, I was so happy. I was elated when that happened.
You were elated.
I was the Steelers elated. Against who?
It was the Pirates against the Reds.
Oh, sorry.
we're talking real sports over here.
Anyways, moving on.
Who won the game?
The Reds. To put them
our
into
baseball
the
team. No, you're supposed to say the Bears.
Oh,
anyways, go ahead.
You're doing a Bears. Yeah.
I'm reaching for references. Anyway, go ahead.
My number four. Are you done, Jeff?
Yeah, I'm done.
Okay. My number four. Peter Warrick and the Bengals beating the 9-0 Kansas City Chiefs. The Chiefs come to town a couple of years, about 5 years ago, 6 years ago.
Well, Peter Warrick was on the, yeah, that was more like 15 years ago.
Okay, whatever. I think it was 04. And
I remember that.
I covered his mouth.
Peter Warrick?
Yes.
Good man. They came into town. Chiefs were 9-0. Toast of NFL. And Peter Warrick runs a punt back to take the lead. And ever since then, it was just downhill for the Chiefs. They start losing the fumble. Bengals went on to win. It was basically Bengals' moment that they actually finally turned the corner to actually beat a good team for once.
So that was the one good play that Peter Warrick had in his professional career?
Yes.
Okay. I think the other one was selling his Heisman, right?
Well, that was the one that I remember. I still remember Peter Warrick running it back.
Did you pick up his Heisman for delivery? When he had to sell it to the buyer?
Yeah. That was the span of a couple years that the Bengals just kept picking Heisman winners. Didn't work out too well.
Did he buy insurance on that?
On the Heisman?
Yeah, through the mail.
Peter Warrick was on the Bengals from 2000 to 2004.
No, it was 2004 then. So, go ahead.
And he only played four games in 2004.
Yeah, he was the punt returner too, yeah. Or kick returner.
Sticking with my women's soccer, 1999 Women's World Cup in U.S. in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. That's where Brandi Chastain ripped her shirt off.
Mm-hmm.
That's not why it was my favorite, though.
That's why it was an honorable mention.
That's why I made it number four, not five.
Okay.
Shirtless Chastain, sports bra. No, we beat China in a shootout, which goes to my theory for all our football fans that shootouts suck, and they're a product of stupid European policy. But I should say, if they really wanted to make football better in overtime. Soccer okay, for sorry. You, unintelligent world person.
Make that feel well, smart. You realize the word soccer comes from England. England gave us the word soccer.
All right, so for Sabutio, what I'm saying is that the benches, instead of going to shootouts after you do your two overtime periods, you play to the death, the golden goal, remove all your starters. And you have to play the rest of your bench.
Why to the
You play till they're dead?
Golden goal.
To the pain?
Sudden death, is that what you mean?
Sudden death, yeah. Golden goal. Sudden, yeah. Go to the death. That way, your substituting is going to be different. And if you just have one or two superstars on your team, you're going to suck if you don't have any bench to play.
But why to the pain?
Because it will hurt more.
Mm-hmm. Is all your top five soccer?
No.
Okay, good. Well, you know there's no Browns top five moments on there.
There's no Browns top five moments.
Drafting.
No, not even that. We suck at that, too. So stop
it. I almost put when the Browns drafted Johnny Manziel as one of my top fives.
Yeah, Amari Cooper was out there this year. Anyways, move on. Doug, what's your number four?
Okay, I have a tie.
Oh, God.
Now, the rest of them I've been, everything I attended. So it was the Orioles playing the Brewers in 1990. They lost. It's the only game I've ever been to. It was the old Memorial Stadium. The night before, Cal Ripken had passed Everett Scott for second place all time. So I saw the one after
that. That hack!
Oh. And then...
Everett Scott?
Yes, Everett Scott.
And then the 2009 Orange Bowl where UC played Virginia Tech.
UC being the University of Cincinnati.
Yes, for University of Cincinnati.
People not in our city here.
You have people outside the city listen?
We I don't do. Think we have anybody left in the city that listens.
That's the ironic part.
You have to explain that for the one guy in Ghana who keeps downloading us every week.
We have some Switzerland this week.
Yeah. So it was a crappy game, but just the to be in a BCS game was fantastic.
I remember going to the Detroit for the Motor City Bowl with the University of Cincinnati, and they lost to Marshall, and the only thing they hit was the Marshall team on the sidelines when they got into a fight with them. That was about the only thing they were hitting that day. It was a rough day. It was also the same hotel room. I think there was eight of us that slept in a room. Nobody snored, though. How you doing, Jeff? Anyways, moving on.
What, you think no. I'm worried about throw the fact cough that drops I snore? At you.
Anyways, number three.
Number three. Another baseball game I went to. We went to see the Pirates play. CC Sabathia was pitching against him for the Brewers. And
yeah, obviously after the Indians traded him away when we were having a losing season. Yes,
yes, yes, yes, it was bad.
I still say he threw a no-hitter. The only one they gave got Andy LaRoche hit one back to the mound. Usually, okay, if it hits the pitcher, it's not an error. It wasn't hit that hard. He had plenty of time to pick up the ball and throw the guy out, and he messed up. And they called it a hit. It would have been a no-hitter.
And you missed it. And they missed it.
I was there. I was there. It's a no-hitter.
Yeah, but you're confusing CC Sabathia's size and weight as, you know, not moving fast enough. Is that what you're saying? Because CC's a big boy.
Yeah, but once he starts going down the pitcher's mound, it's all momentum, man. It just keeps going.
That's why he threw so well. That momentum coming down the mound.
Whoosh. Although I know that, you know, that's how it is ruled, you know, pitcher's errors or whatnot. But in my opinion... pitchers shouldn't be able to make errors because part of pitching is fielding your position. So if it shouldn't go against an unearned run or anything.
He should at least use his head to stop the line drives.
Yeah, exactly. Like you do. I was just disappointed no one then went after the ball after it sailed into the air.
After it hit you?
I mean, nobody made an attempt to catch it. I know, exactly. Somebody should have caught that. But
hey, champs. Anyways, Blake, what's your number three?
My number three, it's a tie, and let's go back to the Olympics. Two female Olympians. The first one, remember, Carrie Strug with her ankle.
Uh-huh. You can do it, Carrie Strug.
You can do it, Carrie Strug. She had to do the vault for the ankle, and the team wins the gold.
Mm-hmm. Yay!
And then, of course, everybody's favorite, Mary Lou Retton. Yeah, back in 1984.
Perfect 10 on the vault.
Perfect 10 on the vault, winning by .05 for the gold for
Yay!
USA.
Yay!
Except there were no Eastern European countries there.
Yeah, except all the communists.
Yeah, except all the communists boycotted that one. But
doesn't matter how you win. Default.
Still counts. That's right.
My number three is I was not there, but I've seen this 1,000 times, and I watched the whole game. I think I've seen the whole game almost probably every year the last couple years. The Do You Believe in Miracles, the U.S. beating Russia.
Son of a bitch. That's like number one.
Yeah! I took down two number ones today.
Okay, we have to crucify Jason.
That's right. The Miracle on Ice.
How old were you?
One. But I have... I wasn't there.
You watched it.
I have watched it several times. And 30 for 30, yeah, had a nice one about actually from the Russian perspective and how they were all like... We didn't know what the fuck we were doing. Like, we were screwed after that. We're going back to Russia like, son of a bitch.
Herb Sendek. Yeah, we're going back to Russia. We're going to be executed.
And then Herb went on to coach France.
Herb Sendek. Yeah, he, you know, his movie Miracle.
Great film.
Good. Great movie, too. Anybody who likes sports and the psychology of sports and players and coaching should watch that movie.
Again.
Who do you play for?
The United States of America!
Finally.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Jeff. What's your number two?
How about my number three?
Yeah. You can do number these three. Are your last two because your number one's gone.
Yeah,
taking true. Everyone
number
down.
One. Took everyone down. You know, that's like me doing the bat cave for number five. Yep. I'm gonna get you next week.
Bring it.
That's right.
Yeah, you did that because you knew I was going to play.
You knew that. I was going to be everybody's number one. Miracle on Ice.
My number three.
Hockey, especially hockey.
Number three. Jeff, what's your number two?
My number three.
Whatever.
My number three is the Bartman game. Oh, the Cubs. Chicago Cubs. Because I hate the Cubs. The worst part about it was everybody bitched about Steve Bartman hitting that ball and blah, blah, blah.
Catching the ball from Moises Alou.
Everybody else... Oh, he didn't even catch the ball.
Well.
Bartman. But everybody else in that area was going for the ball. Bartman was just the one that had hit.
My biggest issue is not that. It's nobody remembers that Gonzalez screwed up the next play.
Alex Gonzalez made an error on the next play, and that's why they lost.
Yeah, let's be real here.
They made him an unfair goat.
Chicago?
Probably because he looked goofy nerd with headphones on catching a ball. And they said, I hate that guy.
And then they're throwing their beer and pizza at him. I'm like, seriously, dude?
Everybody would have done the same damn thing.
How much did you fucking pay for that beer and pizza? It is not worth throwing at anybody for any reason.
I want the same thing to happen this year.
2003.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah, with the Cubs in the playoffs. What's your number two?
And you know, it'd be even better if it was him again.
I'm back, bitches!
My number two was the 2001 World Series, where Luis Gonzalez got the hit off of the Yankees closer. What's his name? The Yankees closer.
Rivera?
Yeah,
Rivera.
That's his name.
Sorry, not Soriano.
Yes, Mariano Rivera.
No, you're thinking Major League.
Yes. But
Allstate guy.
I mean, it was
Serrano.
You know, it was the World Series after the 9/11, and everybody, oh, it's so apt that New York is going to win. I'm like, fuck New York, fuck the Yankees. They don't deserve to win just because their city was attacked. So I was so happy when another team beat the Yankees. Nothing to do with politics. It has everything to do with I fucking hate the Yankees.
Good man. Well, your number one's already gone, too, so...
That's the whole NFL conspiracy, too. The Patriots win the Super Bowl.
If you notice, my top three are on there. Not because I liked the team. It's because I hated the Cubs, and when something bad happened to them, I liked them. I hated the Yankees, and they lost. You know, they just won 4 out of 5 World Series, and everyone's talking about it's fate that they win this. I'm like, no. So I'm glad the Diamondbacks beat them. And then my number one, obviously... Kentucky, so God, I hate them, worst fans ever. So Duke beating Kentucky, especially the Christian Leitner shot, the stomp. Oh, that was great.
Grant Hill.
And my brother won his poll, his NC2A poll that year, and so he was able to pay me back the money he owed me.
So. My number two is a Blue Jays fan, Joe Carter.
Oh, boo!
Hitting the game winning home run
in
the World Series.
Oh, wait a minute. Was that the year Toronto was... winning?
I'm still a Blue Jays fan.
Sure you are.
Jesse Barfield, man.
Whatever. Toronto's winning this year.
Oh, fuck you all. Okay, shut up.
We are winning this year.
I'm a Toronto Blue Jays hoodies for the last 5 years, okay? Don't be saying that.
We got a Houston Astros jersey in the corner for it.
I actually got all the teams right there. I just wait. Joe Carter, 92-93.
That hurt. I was cheering for that Phillies team.
Yeah, fuck them. Anyway,
that was such a great
team. They would have won 94, too, but the fucking strike. Grant, they were out of first place by like 10 games.
Montreal would have won. They would have stayed in Canada.
No, the Indians would have won because of the strike.
I can't work on a...
Yes, they were because of the weird, goofy-ass bullshit they came up with. They kept the Indians out of the playoffs.
Yeah, it's all
good. And then they made it to the playoffs the next year. Wah, wah, wah.
Shut up.
Lost to the Marlins. Anyway.
I mean, Montreal lost their fucking team because of the strike.
That was the Braves that year.
Yeah, they lost to the Braves that year.
Cleveland misery straight, okay?
I just remember watching and going, man, that would be great if Joe Carter hit a home run just to end it. Hey, he just did. What the fuck? Yeah.
Now, granted, it was Mitch Williams who I wasn't a big fan of. And I thought, oh, don't put Mitch Williams out there. No, don't put Mitch Williams out there.
So, that was my number two. Blake, what's your number two? Three? What are you at?
Two? Just a correction.
Two. Yes, you're at two. Right.
It was Herb Brooks, Herb not Brooks. Herb Sendek.
Yeah. There's only so many Herbs in sports to keep track of.
Two.
And he just screwed it up.
I'm obviously at 0%. All right, so I had a 50-50 chance.
But he was at least a coach.
That's right.
I didn't get the first name right.
I got Herb. There you go. I was going to say Kurt Russell. Kurt Russell was coaching the
Cleveland
Ice.
That's okay. What's your number two?
Number two.
Tim Couch being drafted.
Keeping my ties together. First one would be the they're both Ohio State Buckeyes. 2002 Ohio State Buckeyes, yep. National champions over University of Miami.
Yep.
That was the year Bednar was working the AV guy director for like Marriott Hotels, and he brought this projector, and I had my condo. And so we watched this the whole championship on the wall of my condo because I had like chapel ceilings in there. Mm-hmm. So it was like a 10-foot by 10-foot screen, and we won. And that was the first time we experienced a football championship, so we didn't know what to do.
you rioted and burnt things down.
His own condo.
So we threw my couch out the window, set it on fire. People down at the pool were upset, but hey, you know, that's what happened.
I'll show you.
That's right. You know what the thing I like about that year, 2002, they're known as the Gold Pants winner, Gold Pants Award.
Why?
Because they're undefeated for that season.
Oh, okay.
So if you go undefeated, you're the Gold Pants team, which I have no reason why that comes about because I'm, you know, Buckeye history. I'm sure Bednar can correct me. But maybe I'd do something at the end of the game, end of the year, and you beat the Wolverines. They wear gold pants. I don't know who it is. But then, of course, the other one last year, Ohio State Buckeyes. That's right. Even after we won the undisputed championship, Mark May still had us ranked third, I think, in his final. They still had Alabama number one, Florida State two, and then Ohio State
Kentucky three, UK three.
Exactly.
But in defense of him, if Ohio State was in the SEC last year, they would have had a losing record, correct?
Oh, of course. Because the SEC is so great.
Yeah. I would still want to see one of those SEC schools march up to Wisconsin in the middle of November and try to play the way they play football up there. Those fast guys are going to get hurt so bad.
Doug, what's number two?
Number two, 1983, Johnny Bench Night.
Oh!
Last game, and he hit a home run. The place went wild. It was just fantastic. I wasn't even that big of a Bench fan.
But
it was
love Bench.
That was a great, great game. I think they lost, but...
Well. It was 83, so I'm sure they did.
Yeah.
I'm kind of surprised you didn't have for a tie, because you're an older gentleman. Wouldn't you have realized...
You're an older gentleman.
Wouldn't you have watched the Cleveland Indians 5-cent beer night coupled with death to disco home game where the crowd got drunk and then rioted and burned?
When was that?
Yeah, that was when you were a kid. I can't remember the day. This was the 70s. It was the Death of Disco night, and it was like, bring your disco
I don't remember.
Yeah.
I'm 46. I'm not that old.
Yeah, you would have been perfect.
you're a year older than Blake, and he's calling you the old man.
4 years younger than Jeff.
For the record,
yeah,
I have a kid in kindergarten.
He's viral.
You're viral.
Did you mean virile?
I thought you were actually making a joke. I'm like, that's a really good joke, Jason. No, you meant viral, didn't you? You didn't mean viral. Oh my goodness.
You meant viral.
No, but it was
viral.
Death to Disco night, and it was also a 5-cent beer night. And it's the reason why Major League Baseball doesn't do 5-cent beer nights anymore, because the crowd rioted during the Death to Disco segment of the game.
Heidi, heidi, ho.
Heidi, heidi, ho. Heidi, heidi, ho. Death Disco.
Okay.
Signed by Mofo.
You didn't get the looks in the family. Definitely didn't get the brains in the family. Okay, number one. Now I'm going to take a page out of Jeff's book here and go with a non-professional sport.
Oh, okay.
You know, I have a son in college, too, so I'm an old guy. So.
You're pretty viral. We established that.
You somehow are able to infect your wife still.
So, I coached my son's not whole games. I was third base coach. I could probably pick five out of there. Not even concerning him, just other kids. It was fantastic. But in one of the games, we were playing for first place, and they had this superstar kid. It was awesome. Hit a home run in the first inning. My son comes up in the bottom of the first, two men on. Hits a home run over dead center. Granted, it was only like 250 feet, but, you know.
Still counts.
But that was just fantastic. I don't think he did crap the rest of the game, but...
Did you peg the guy that hit the home run on the other team?
No.
Okay. I didn't know if you did a Papelbon thing on it.
No, no.
Papelbon.
No, no.
What are you doing?
That was just fantastic. Like I said, they're coaching Noddle. I mean, you can get plenty of memories out of that. But
okay,
that's number one.
So Fish's home run.
And then he, so he Fish won the championship there. And then years later, he tells me he shows up. He misses some games for his uncle's softball team. And then he shows up, and the night he shows up, they win the championship.
They do. We do.
It was just, you know, he's like...
Default.
Yeah. It was
default.
That was almost number one.
Yeah, and that was close. Well, that is my number one. It's the default. No, I'm just kidding.
It didn't require a line drive off of Jeff's head.
Number two, one, since I read, Joe Oliver, game two. Down the line, game-winning hit in World Series game two, 1990, against the Oakland Athletics. Because I remember watching an interview with the Oakland Athletics before they came to Cincinnati in Game 1, and it was 1990.
Everybody picked Oakland to win.
Everybody picked Oakland to win. Everybody
picked Oakland to sweep.
They thought Oakland was going to sweep.
And Mark McGwire points out his finger with his ring from 1989 and says, like MC Hammer says, you can't touch this. Fuck you. Anyways, go do some more.
Specifically the Oliver hit?
Yeah, but Joe Oliver. Fuck that whole series.
Billy Bates.
Yes. I remember laying in bed, and we weren't allowed to watch it because it was past our bedtime, my bedtime. We had the black and white TV, and I remember watching it go down the line and just jumping, yes! So, Billy Bates. That's a fun little fact. I don't think he ever showed up again. So, good for him. But, yeah, that was my number one. Honorable mention, Nolan Ryan beating up Robin Ventura.
Oh, I forgot that one.
That was my favorite ones. Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, just don't charge Nolan
No.
Ryan.
No.
Nolan Ryan's a badass.
Let's see. Honorable mentions I had when Randy Johnson hit the bird.
That was funny.
I had when...
And exploded.
When Russ Springer took 5 pitches to hit Barry Bonds. Only because one went behind his head and hit his bat for a strike. So then on the fifth hit, on the fifth pitch, he hit him and then got ejected from the game. I had the day that Bart Giamatti suspended Pete Rose.
Oh, great day. Great day. Great day.
And
I think number one might be when he gets not, he doesn't get reinstated. It's going to be a great day.
And when Norm Charlton...
Plows
Mike Socia, a relief pitcher who probably shouldn't be running the bases anyway, runs through the sign at third.
While wearing a Reds jacket.
Yeah, because the pitchers are allowed to wear the jacket. Yes. And just plows into the catcher, who's pretty much known for being the best blocker of the plate, and just levels him to score the winning run.
Yes. Back when they had attitude.
And my other honorable mention was that time in softball that I hit a triple.
Okay. Blake?
Legitimate triple?
It was.
Legitimate triple?
Yeah.
Legitimate triple.
It would have been a home run, but I stumbled grounding third, so I had to go back. Otherwise, I was going to fall flat on my face rounding third. So.
Yeah, that's true.
Blake?
Let's see. A couple ones. The game where the Browns were in contention to make the playoffs, and the refs, after the play had executed by the Jacksonville Jaguars, decided, hey, you know what? We should have reviewed that one play from before, and they reversed everything on the field, and all the Cleveland fans threw beer bottles onto the field. That's why you're not allowed to have plastic beer bottles anymore at NFL football stadium.
Blasphemy.
Yeah, it was blasphemy. Let's see. What's another infamous favorite sports moment? Oh, yeah, that one game where the Browns were winning at the end of regulation, but we lost because of a defensive penalty, and therefore the team scored a touchdown on the very next play. The only team that's winning at the end of regulation to officially lose without going into overtime.
It's happened in basketball.
Yeah, fuck basketball.
Probably the Cavs.
Michael Jordan.
Your honorable mention could all be Cleveland Browns.
They could all be Cleveland Browns' interesting things.
Why?
Exactly.
Well, I will say one event that I was actually at that was pretty memorable was the Bengals game against Seattle when people were throwing snowballs on the field and Sam Leish got on the announce and says, hey, you don't live in Cleveland.
You don't live in Cleveland. And everyone's like, hey. Yeah, I remember that. That was pretty funny.
I was at the game and I had no clue what he said. I found out when I got home what he said.
Doug, any honorable mention?
Orioles winning the World Series. I went to an Indians game in 94 and they were playing Texas. And George Bush the senior sat down. You know, we were up a little bit. Mm. He was down in front of us. Mm. And one of the
did you talk to him like Ian Zero?
No, somebody bought him a beer though.
Oh. I was about to say, did he buy the whole section beer?
No,
that would have been cool.
He was like,
waved, and that was pretty cool.
Yeah. One of my honorable mentions
George
is
Senior. Did you? Personally, yeah, him and Barbara in Lisbon, Portugal. It was pretty cool.
Guys just hang out on the beach.
We just hung out on the beach. Okay. Nude sunbathing.
Yeah, dude. Oh, I thought it was
the president. I mean,
no, this was when Clinton was president.
Oh, okay,
and it was at the ambassador's house to Portugal. And what I do remember, I don't remember who she was or what her name was. She was the ambassador to Portugal. She was married, but the entire foyer had her and Bill, like 100 pictures of her and Bill all over the damn place. In weird situations, like at dinner, at a restaurant.
Doggy style.
Things or whatever.
Missionary.
None of that kind of stuff. Probably she has those too. Or Bill
those
does
in the bedroom,
wallet.
Not the foyer.
Yeah, but I remember standing in that house going, this lady's married. There's like one picture of her and her husband, and the rest are her with Bill Clinton all
the
time.
But it's actually
place.
Him, the husband photobombing them with Bill. And it's my husband back there.
Husband was the one taking the pictures.
Yeah, exactly. I wonder, how she got that job. Anyways.
My last honorable mention is my brother and I went to the Tampa Bay Baltimore Orioles game in Baltimore. And Jason Tyner for the Tampa Bay Devil Rays. Yes, Jason Tyner. Nobody knows him anymore. Yeah. He was in right field. It was a boring game. So we started chanting, Tyner, Tyner, like they did with Strawberry. And by the fourth inning of that, we had the whole section chanting it. And by the fifth inning, he turned around and just smirked and smiled and shook his head. And we kept doing it through the rest of the game. Not the first inning, but the rest of the game for 8 innings. Every time he came out, he just smirked and shook his head. So, like, why are you picking on a guy that's batting .220? That's not even on Baltimore. So, Jason Tyner. Let's see. Bad idea of the week. Doug and I got this from a vendor at the Cincinnati Comic Expo.
Oh, what's the bad idea?
Number 787, closing the gates of hell over in Middle East somewhere. I forget where it was. Because no other tourist attractions are around. She doesn't have a problem closing them. But she said, since you have nothing else in the country that people are going to be looking for, you know, tourists, she thinks it's a bad idea. So we're going to go with her. So yes. So... but that's about it.
So they're saying Gates of Hell tourist attraction was the only thing in this area.
Yes.
And
they're closing it. It's like this giant...
Were people actually showing up?
Oh, that's... yeah, there's a giant cavern. You can Google it. It's pretty impressive.
So everybody Google Gates of Hell and be upset that you can no longer go there.
Yes. Maybe it was the Ukraine. Was it Ukraine?
I think it was the Ukraine.
Yeah, I think it is Ukraine. Maybe not in the Middle East. That would be Russia area. Anyways. So, Doug, thanks for coming on.
Oh,
thanks
my
for
pleasure. My pleasure.
Frank Walker, Tomorrowland.
Does Jim bring you gifts?
No. Herpes, but that's about it. So.
Well, Jim did bring the Coney Island Brewing hard root beer.
Oh.
That's true. That's true. So, Roger says goodbye.
Goodbye. From Walking Dead to Talking Heads, from comic books to TV sets, there's a history of not so bad. There's the history. It's the history of bad. So bad. The history of bad. It's bad. The history of bad ideas. Podcast. You are now leading the world of Musings of a Geek Podcast Network. Stay geeky, my friends.